Good morning once again, and welcome to the forum here on Asasa Radio 99.5 megahertz, the voice of our land. As you already know, on the forum, we bring you dispassionate conversations and insightful analysis on some of the topical news items making the headlines in the past week, as well as matters that are of importance to you and important that we discuss them because of our dear nation, Ghana. As always, my name is Dr. Kweku Ajimanbudu, and I'm your host, and I will be at the helm of affairs from now until 11 a.m. But before we start our substantive discussions, let's keep it real. Week by large sections of Ghanaians on social media, which is eventually taking over the mainstream media landscape. And what is this clarion call all about? It's about ordinary Ghanaians, mostly young people, venting their frustration, not necessarily or directly aimed at this particular government, but rather successive governments and their seeming failure in improving the conditions of ordinary Ghanaians. But of course, it is the NPP that is in power now, having just won a presidential election and being given the mandate to govern for the next 4 years. So naturally, a lot of the agitations and problems being highlighted by the Fix the Country movement will be directed against the NPP government. That is to be expected. And some of the problems being highlighted include rising youth unemployment, erratic power and water supply, bad roads, corruption, rising cost of living, poor sanitation, galamsey activities ongoing, a perceived culture of silence, the city depreciation, and so on and so forth. But what was the immediate reaction and response from some government factionaries and sympathizers of the ruling MPP? A counter hashtag, fix yourself. Well, I'm no communication professional, neither do I have any particular expertise in political communications. But even if all the people promoting and supporting the Fix the Country movement were opposition personalities and functionaries, which I believe they are not all of them, that is, fix yourself is definitely not an appropriate response. That's because it smacks of arrogance and at first sight does not necessarily respond to some of the legitimate issues being highlighted by the proponents of Fix the Country. Thankfully, it became, we are fixing it, Nana is fixing it, he's fixing it, let's fix it together, etc. Which to me is generally respectful of the Fix the Country movement, seeing that these are ordinary Ghanaian youth essentially exercising one form of their civil and political rights. My question, however, is this. Is it a legitimate call for citizens to fix themselves for the collective good? The inescapable conclusion I arrive at is that Fix the Country and Fix Yourself can be seen as two sides of the same metaphorical coin, which is our homeland, Ghana. On one hand, we vote for successive governments to fix the country. That is not in dispute, and we should continuously hold governments to account. But on the other hand, we, the citizens of Ghana, have the duty to be good citizens in all respects and in all facets of our day-to-day lives. I do not think that any Ghanaian who has lived in Ghana for the past decade or so can deny the fact that we have a collective problem in Ghana that transcends political party affiliation. Indiscipline. We are inherently an indisciplined people, and it's about time we restart a national conversation about this and take concrete action towards its eradication, if possible. Indiscipline, which has led to lawlessness and impunity, has characterized much of this Fourth Republic of ours. We drive on the shoulders of the road whenever there's traffic. We engage in illegal electricity connection. We pay bribes. We throw rubbish on the streets like it's nobody's business. We even engage in illegal mining, destroying our water bodies, etc. But that does not, however, mean that we give our government a free ride in all of this. And that's why Fix the Country and Fix Yourself epitomizes the state of our dear homeland, Ghana. For in one breath, successive governments, even though they have tried their best in advancing the lives of the people, have generally failed in delivering on their promises and have not been firm in inculcating an enforcement culture. And in another breath, we the people have also failed woefully to be good citizens in holding governments to account, either because of our political affiliations or because we benefit from the lack of an enforcement culture and generally profit from doing the wrong thing. So let this clarion call to fix the country serve as a reminder to all of us to play our part in nation building by reflecting on the following words, and I quote, "Hail to thy name, O Ghana, to thee we make our solemn vow, steadfast to build together a nation strong in unity, with our gifts of mind and strength of arm, whether night or day, in the midst of storm, in every need, whatever the call may be, to serve thee, Ghana, now and evermore." So you're still listening to The Forum here on Asasa Radio 99.5 MHz. We're streaming on Facebook at Asasa Radio 99.5. We're also on, you can listen to us in Kumasi on Asasa Radio 98.5 MHz, as well as in Tamale on 123 FM. We're also on YouTube, that is, on Asasa Radio, Asasa TV Official, that is, 99.5 MHz. Today we'll be talking about a number of issues that have come up in the past week. As you are already aware of, the Fix the Country movement has captivated and captured the attention of many on social media and even on mainstream media. And that's one of the things we'll be talking about with our panelists. We'll also be talking about fuel price politics, because there was something that happened in the past week. There was an increment, slight increment in the prices of fuel, and then there was a revision downwards and matters arising in that regard. And then we'll be revisiting a conversation that we've had in the past regarding senior secondary schools in Ghana and some decisions that they take in line with your school rules, which may affect the religious freedoms of sections of the students. So these are the conversations that we'll be having, and we have some wonderful guests who will be helping us with these conversations shortly, and I'll introduce them shortly so that you get to know who we'll be talking to. But the first topic that we'll be discussing is the Fix the Country issue. We want our roads fixed, we want water, and we want electricity. We want taxes and the prices of petroleum products reduced. And indeed, we want to have the sense that things are working in this country. That seems to be the message in the hashtag getting many Ghanaians talking on social media about the need for the situation that we find ourselves in to change. Already, some international media houses are carrying the concerns, which was trending number two, and even I think number one on Twitter at some point in time in Ghana, when we checked. I spoke to a person who started this whole campaign, or we spoke to a person who started this whole campaign on why they initiated this Fix the Country Now movement. Let's listen to what they had to say.
For a public demonstration, you can't be sure of how many people turning up. But, well, interestingly, we still want to prevent a spike in COVID cases. But aside the churches, we have market activities taking place. And if you visit our market, you don't have people being socially distanced, and we say we are going to do that. And when our representatives were at a meeting yesterday with national security and the ministers, they clearly explained how that was going to happen. Because every demonstrator will be spaced 6 feet apart, and everybody will be in masks. Nobody will be screaming or shouting. We've already given that information out, and we have a starting point for the demonstration. And I believe that everybody who comes will be reminded of that, and we proceed in an orderly manner.
However, the Member of Parliament for Nshiaiso constituency in the Ashanti region, the Honourable Dr. Stephen Amwa, has put out strong reservations about the ongoing social media movement Fix the Country Now. So social media users, especially on Twitter, have been criticizing successive governments, particularly the present government, demanding better roads, fewer taxes, good salaries, amongst other things that we've mentioned earlier on. And the hashtag has been trending since last Saturday, prompting responses from some government officials as well as some members of the ruling New Patriotic Party. So speaking to Assassin News earlier this week, Dr. Stephen Amoah said that if it had not been for the COVID pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic, Ghana's development story would have been different.
We are not in good times. That one is a fact. It's 100% factual or correct. But let's ask ourselves. We have to be rational and very objective. We don't have to be making statements out of arbitrariness. It is a global issue or not. Not until this COVID-19 happened, what was happening in our country. And even now that it's happening, we don't live, we're not an island. South Africa here, as I'm talking to you now, please go and check. Leadership is now intending to slash or reduce even salaries of public. Their deficit is predicted to get to about 14.something%. It is extremely, very, very, very bad. It's extremely bad. It's even worse than the situation in Ghana. All over the world, look at the economy because of COVID-19.
Meanwhile, local government expert Dr. Eric Odro Osai is questioning the basis of the demands by the online demonstrators. According to him, the government was formed not long ago and Parliament has just approved the budget for work to begin.
I don't know what the thing wants the government to fix, because this is a new government. The government is 4 months. The government is in 8 months. I think the government the government sometimes, more to the point, we are all aware of this pandemic. Parliament has just approved a budget for the government to implement. The government is just about implementing the budget because taxes would have to be subsidized in the first quarter. So I really think that the fix the country now agenda is moot. I think that they should take that government. They have the right to express their view. They have their right to demonstrate. I think when you are expressing this right, and these demonstrations, you should take into consideration the fundamentals of the situation on the ground. In my candid opinion, I think very much not.
Meanwhile, the New Patriotic Party that has formed the current government says it is in the process of fixing the challenges citizens are faced with in the country. As you are aware, the Fix the Country Now campaign has become a major topic on social and mainstream media, with the initiators even serving notice of a public protest to drive home their demands for what they describe as for some of the things they want, including better road networks, jobs, quality healthcare, and so on and so forth. But speaking on Assassin News, the national chairman of the New Patriotic Party, Mr. Freddie Blaine, says the government is taking steps to realize the demands of the citizenry.
People maybe want some of these challenges immediately taken care of, but it doesn't take, it's not a magic wand that will bring about positive results. We are on it, work in progress. You talk about access to electricity. It's, give me a break, what's happening? Ghana government, talking about Nnamdi Kanu government, is tackling it. GRIKO, the distribution network, been fixed. Things have gone down a bit. And they've given notice to Ghanaians that within a question of months, everything has been fixed. And that is not that we didn't foresee anything like this. There have been pressure on it from a little time immemorial since we had. Nothing new had gone on in terms of distribution.
Meanwhile, the hashtag Fix the Country campaigners have vowed to resist what they call an unlawful order by the Ghana Police Service, asking them to back down on their May 9th demonstration due to the COVID-19 pandemic. One of the leading members or conveners of the campaigners had this to say. All right, so we don't have that voice now. We'll try and bring it to you when we have it. Meanwhile, the public relations officer of the Accra Regional Police, DSP Efiatenge, says the police have not changed their stance, saying leaders of the group will not be spared should they breach the ban on public gathering. I believe we're having some technical challenges. So we'll bring you those voices once we have them. The conveners of this campaign is also questioning or are also questioning the police's objection to the planned protest on May 9th, 2021. And we know that in the past week, the police have secured an order from the High Court to restrain the conveners from embarking on the protest until the ban on public gatherings due to COVID-19 is lifted. But speaking on Asasi Breakfast Show, one of the conveners, Standuga, argued that there are several avenues, including markets and churches, which are possible avenues for the spread of COVID-19, but the police are doing very little about them. He reiterated the group's commitment to ensure that the protocols will be observed. He was, however, not certain whether the group will go ahead with the protest or not. And in a related development, communications expert Dr. Laurie Japon says government failed to communicate properly some of the policies it implemented, which contributed to the social media campaign Fix the Country Now. The movement, which was started last Saturday, came on the back of increment in fuel prices and talk time, as well as data volumes. And speaking to Assassin News, Dr. Laurie Japon said there is public backlash due to the poor communication on the part of the government.
I think that the communication didn't come early enough, you know, and that is what created the problem. Because when you go and read a budget and you talk about the taxes that you are putting on things, you need to let people understand and communicate it properly before you even come out with those taxes. What happened is that a lot of people woke up to being hit by increments in a lot of things without understanding why, after enjoying the free things we did in 2020, we are being told that we have to pay for it.
Meanwhile, head of History and Political Studies Department at the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, Dr. Samuel Dujemfi, has also said that governments must simply sit up, shut up, and fix the challenges Ghanaians are facing. I believe we do not have that sound as well. And so we'll simply, that's basically the context within which we situate this particular Fix the Country discussion. And I already have my guests seated in the studio, and I'll introduce them to you. Now we have with us once again, the Honorable Ayikwe Otu, who is a former Attorney General of the Republic of Ghana and immediate past High Commissioner of Ghana to Canada. Your Excellency, welcome once again. Good morning. We also have with us, returning for the first time after our very first program, after taking a hiatus from us, he's returning. We have Lawyer Yao Pong, who's a private legal practitioner, who's joined us again. So welcome.
Thank you very much. Good to be here.
Thank you. And for the first time joining us, we have Madame Suzanne Edu Amankwa, who is a member of the Convention People's Party.
Sorry, wrong.
It's wrong.
Yeah, it's wrong.
Sorry. Can you correct me, please?
I'm no longer a member of the Convention People's
Party. Oh, you're no longer a member of Convention People's Party. Okay.
So you should have asked me before.
Sorry, that's my fault. Sorry about
be
that.
Very unhappy with
how would you like us to address you?
I'm a citizen of Ghana.
You're a citizen of Ghana.
Yes, and a member of a movement called National Interest Movement.
National Interest Movement. Yes. So we have Madame Suzanne Edu Amankwa, a citizen of Ghana, as she had, and a member of a movement called the Ghana National Interest Movement. Thank you, Madame, for joining us today for the first time. And apologies for the mix-up.
Well, all right. I mean, it's to be expected.
Yeah. All right. So you've all heard the context that we set this particular conversation and the Fix the Country movement that has sort of captivated all our attention in the past week. I'll start with the Honorable Ayikwe Otu. What do you make of all that has happened? First and foremost, the movement that sprang up, Fix the Country, the response that came immediately, Fix Yourself, and the back and forth, and what's happening right now. Generally, your general thoughts before we delve into the specifics.
Okay, thank you. I don't think it's anything new. We've seen it over the years. We've had demonstrations. We've had Preku and all kinds of demonstrations in the past. Of course, the citizens have the right to expect something from their government. The issue that arises, rather, is whether it is being done with some ulterior motive. In other words, whether there is the minority or what we call an opposition or something in the background pushing. Otherwise, from what we saw, an individual started something by saying, oh, just fix it. And then it caught on. And then everybody started saying, especially when it got to the celebrities, you know, because they have followers. So when celebrities get on the bandwagon, it changes the dynamics. So it's been on. But I read a statement that they put out when they were intending to go on the demonstration. I like the use of the word successive governments, you know, which makes it clear that these are problems that have been around for some time. And what is development? Like somebody says, well, how are we applying our technology to solve some of these problems? And do we really have them? I remember the first time I appeared, there was this issue of transmission lines and the issue whether we could just easily produce transmission lines or we have to import, which involves money and all that. So finances, it's something that you have to look at, you know, in trying to do your administration. As for the issues, it is when people start saying that, oh, they are borrowed, that we have not seen anything, that becomes worrying. Mm-hmm. Because if you live in a country and you know what is happening, and you intentionally say that I have not seen anything, even when the gutters and or the drains and the roads in your own area are being fixed. We were in this country, talk about underdeveloped unemployment, graduate unemployment and all that. The government tried to come out with NAPCO, you know, and then the youth in afforestation. Mm. We got about 160, you know, youth immediately gotten somewhere compared with what we had at the time when, because of the IMF, World Bank, you know, conditionalities, there was some break in, you know, trying to recruit. So that was a way of trying to resolve the issue. At least some people got some work to do and they had some respite within the period. That is doing something about the problem. And as we chat, I'm sure that more issues will come up. Mm. But to say that nothing has taken place and as if everything has gone bad, I don't think it's fair. I mean, the whole idea of even trying to do railway development, we see the gauges and all things going on, you know, the free SHS, building the human capital, including even free boarding house facilities and all that, you know, the planting for food and jobs, the fortunate thing that happened when we were able to produce a lot of rice and people were even doing the campaign, let's eat Ghana rice, you know, and we're doing some exports around the even in immediate environment, you know, the borders and the rest. I mean, it's not fair to just say nothing has happened. Even working to get ourselves out of the IMF, you know, we did some work and Ghana went out of the IMF and were then free to go on to the capital market and do our own bonds and long-term bonds to raise money and all that, you know. The whole idea of Ghana beyond aid, you know, trying to find out.
But people are saying they don't feel it in their pockets. Oh, yes. The cost of living is still high. There's still unemployment. Mm. There's rising fuel prices, for instance, in the past week. Taxes going up, new taxes as a result of COVID-19. So people are saying, yes, you may be doing all these things, but we don't feel it in our pockets.
Yeah, but that is a period, you know. You have to look at the period. If NPP has been in power for 4 years, was that the situation then? No. Before COVID came, and it's affecting everybody, every country, whether rich or poor. COVID pandemic has affected almost everybody. It's affected the economy. Nothing is happening. Tourism, whatever. Places that you expect to get money. It's not like, you know, it used to be. And then I agree that the raft of measures took place within a short time, especially after Easter. People have been at home, and then schools started reopening around the same time. Then the fuel prices, and then the taxes. You know, if you look at that environment within the period that the thing was happening, of course, I mean, people would complain, but to deliberately say that therefore nothing had happened, so fix it, is not fair. I don't think that it is
so fair. So what you're saying is it should be situated within the proper context.
Exactly.
And shouldn't be laid only at the doorstep of this particular government.
And you realize that even government has done something about the petrol prices. And look, if it's, is it 70 or something?
It was reduced by a few pesos,
It's and the rest. So, of course, the agitations are okay. There has to talk. People, government, which is sensitive, should listen. And therefore, if it becomes clear that where you are going, maybe there is some stabilization, something somewhere that can be looked at and things like that. We can then
look at how best to
reduce the burden on people,
on the people,
leadership and all that.
All right, Madam Eduamanko, I come to you now for just your general thoughts on this particular issue after everyone has his opening thoughts, and then we can delve into specific questions.
Okay. So I was listening to the MP and he says that, it hadn't been the COVID, life would have been good for us. Seriously, if I'd been born in Nigeria, my father would have been Dangote. Same thing. I mean, really? I mean, we're not here about, you know, suppositions and assumptions and things like that. We are living it right now. And in living it, we are feeling the hardship. You know, so you can't come and tell us that if it hadn't been COVID. Look, we can go into the data, but if you take our world in data, it says that the countries that have protected the health of their people best are the ones that the economic impact to has been less. And that's the other way around. The countries that have not protected the health of their people,
the economy has been devastating.
So you can't come and blame everything on COVID. And you see, the desperation that people feel, it has nothing to do with the COVID. It has been building up. And, people are disillusioned because, look, COVID came in the fourth year of this
the government, the first
term. If they had been feeling it in the first three, people would have realized that, okay, yes, the pandemic had made things the same. People were not feeling it then. And the pandemic, just has come and made the feeling even worse.
So it's not the main thing.
It's not the main thing. So I think that going back to blame them, but I want to say something that a friend always says. You know, from where you sit, then you can afford to say certain things. So you can afford to say that it is not fair that people would say that life is hard and that people should situate it in a certain circumstances. Look, if you're going to bed at night and your children are sleeping on an empty stomach, really, I mean...
no one will tell you that
you nobody has to tell you that things are hard. You don't need an opposition person to tell you that things are hard. And we are here in Ghana, when you express how you feel, and if it doesn't agree with the government, then it must be some opposition party that has pushed it in your head to say that you are hungry. Oh, say that you are hungry. What? You don't know that you're hungry. I mean,
our politicians actually think
that we are of such low IQ, of such intelligence, that somebody has to tell us that we are hungry before we say that we are hungry. Somebody has to tell you that you can't pay your rent before you can say that you can't pay your rent. Really? Can ordinary Ghanaians not decide that they are tired, they're hungry, they can't pay their rent, their rivers are polluted, they can see that there's so much corruption, or even if there's a perception of corruption, and that some people are living well and they are not, they need an opposition party member to tell them that? But I guess, like I said, from where you sit, you can afford to say certain things. you know, and it's because life is good for you. Look, in just before the 2016 elections, I won't mention his name, I met an NDC person and we're talking and I said, look, life is hard. He said, oh, Susan, stop the exaggeration. I said, really? I said, life is hard. There are people in this country who earn 200 cedis a month and they can barely make ends meet. Look, if you gave them 5 cedis, you would influence their whole life. So if you are a politician and you give them 20 cedis, they are more likely to even vote for you because they are vulnerable people here. Mm. He said, oh, you people, you do this exaggeration. This was in 2016, the run-up to the election. Yes, the run-up to the election. And he dismissed me that it was an exaggeration. They are doing the same thing. And people, they are dismissing us that, oh, you know, you are, it's not fair for you to say that and you are exaggerating it. I'm feeling the thing. Look, I'm a middle-class Ghanaian.
Mm-hmm.
And yet I feel desperation in me because I look at it and I said, okay, so I'm spending half my income on buying petrol to and fro to work. So do I need to park my car and take the bus or something like that? I'm not a low income Ghanaian. And I feel as if, oh, I can pay my bills, but even the little pleasure of going to sit somewhere to drink a Fanta and a Coke, I may not be able to do that. And somebody needs to tell me that I have to be in opposition before I can do that. I mean, yes, but you see, life is not about living hand to mouth, spending half your money on petrol and spending the other half on paying bills and food that you can eat. And it's about the little things that make you feel like, oh, yes, I can go to church and say, oh, today I can give God 100 cedis. I can't do that. Really, I think that we shouldn't be saying that. It is not fair because... Anyway, like I said, is it from where you sit?
Mm.
Because but if where you sit is okay, you think other people are exact, you can afford to say that.
But, madam, quick one, a quick follow-up on that. Would you then, is it still within the context of it being fair, whether it's fair criticism and all that, this is a government that has just won a mandate to rule for the next 4 years. And we're saying that all these problems have been building up. It's not just the COVID that has released this anger in people and all that. So how do we reconcile the fact that if this situation was there, there was hardship, there was rising cost of living and everything of that sort. COVID came and made things sort of worse. Yes, there were some interventions, but generally things were hard as we are experiencing or people are saying. How then do we reconcile the fact that this same government won in terms of the presidential, was given a mandate to rule for the next 4 years. And within a few months after being given this mandate, we are saying things are hard, people are being agitated, as though we didn't just finish an election.
Okay, two things.
Mm.
And the first one that I feel that is fueling the desperation is that we have a choiceless democracy.
Mm.
I mean, people look at the NPP and are sick to their stomach, but they look at the NDC and are like, ooh, really? You understand? And that is feeding into the desperation. You get it? So it's been building up. And look, people voted for the NPP, not because they like the NDC less. Not because they like the NPP. And they were like, and that desperation in that there doesn't seem to be an alternative. And then so we are torn between the two evils. You understand?
And choosing between the lesser of two evils.
And choosing that. No.
They're equally evil.
And that feeds the desperation. Because you look at it and it looks bleak. The future looks bleak. You're like, I don't like these people. But I don't also like these people. And you are there. And so it is that is feeding their desperation. Mm. You get it? Because the future looks bleak. And it doesn't. If we had the hope of a certain Messiah coming in, we may not be so desperate.
Mm.
But we look at it and we're like, "Ish, you know, come 4 years. Who is? You know, because nobody is excited about maybe the present leadership or the present crop of people who want to fight to be
presidential candidates in the NPP. And nobody's excited about the ones in the NDC either. Mm. So you are looking at a future where, hey, it's these people that are coming back. So it is from this choice of people that they are going to pick a presidential candidate. Hey, really? Yeah, whoa. And then you look at the NDC too, and you're like, you're rising your coupon. And so
you're saying it's a leadership issue.
It's a leadership issue. We are looking at no choice. Mm. We are in a democracy with no choice. Mm. You understand? And if we don't find a way to change direction, you know, and let people have a certain hope. I mean, look, we want things fixed.
Yeah.
We are rational human beings. We know that there's no magic wand and it's not going to happen overnight. Mm. But when you see the trend and the way things are going, you don't feel as if we are going in the right direction. And that also feeds the desperation.
All right. Point well noted, lawyer. Point, I come to you now.
Yes.
So what are your general thoughts and maybe tie it into the question that have we lost trust in the leadership of this country and by extension, have we lost trust in politicians?
Well, good morning. Thank you very much. Let me just start from where Madam ended. I think that if I still remember at the last election, there were 12 presidential candidates. Yeah. So we were spoiled to choice. So it is not, with all due respect, the fact that we had, or we have always had two candidates
to
choose from.
I think you would understand what Madam Susan is saying.
No, I'm not,
at the end of the day, it's two choices that we have.
I'm not misunderstanding her, but I'm saying that as a matter of fact,
we had 12.
Ghanaians were given 12 presidential candidates to choose from. And
ten of whom were not viable.
Well, that is not the point. They qualified to be president. And they presented themselves. Some of them, I think substantial number of them, came from political parties.
Yes.
So as to whether they are viable or not, the fact still remains that we were even spoiled with choice. Mm. I mean, somebody like the Gum man, surprised everybody. Came third with a lot of votes. Mm. So it means that perhaps if people really push for a third, force, even, and the gentleman I understand was just voted for just because of the sort of things he was preaching about or the declarations he was making. So people can still learn from that. So we had a lot of choice. When it comes to parliamentary, there were about 10 or so category of persons that we could have still voted for. And yet, we had a tie for NPP and NDC, but for a gentleman who remembered his roots and decided to go back to his roots. Mm. I mean, it would have been a clear tie with one independent candidate. Mm. So the choices have been there. But I think that I will refer the government to a quote from the Bible, Isaiah 1:18. It says, "Come, let us reason together. Come, let us reason together." This is God. When the people of Israel and maybe perhaps other people he had created as well were lamenting and agitating, and he led them into committing a lot of sins, he asked his own creatures, to come, let us reason together. He didn't impose ideas on them because he heard their lamentations. Mm-hmm. This is not different from, in my view, what we are seeing now. Mm-hmm. So I've said elsewhere that this is an opportunity for the government to apply the same model that we applied for Galamsey. Even if these personalities don't have leaders, at least we have heard some people who have championed it.
The course. Yeah.
The course. If I can even mention Franklin Cudjoe, for example, I mean, he shares some of these ideas, and I think he's not averse, even if he's not a member or a leader, he's not averse to their course.
Yeah.
And some of the other persons, Atimani, some other personalities, invite them, whether at a round table or these days because of COVID, a Zoom meeting or any other meeting, or just ask them, bring a communique. Let us first know the things that are broken. Because your friends say, if it ain't broken,
don't fix it.
Don't fix it. So,
but they're telling you that there's rising unemployment.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that these are oral declarations. You see, it's difficult to fashion solutions for oral declarations. They can bring a communique, and it's also better if you sit applying all the COVID protocols at a round table, face to face, and have a discussion. It's the same thing we did for Galamsey. Are we not at least attempting to do better with Galamsey than previously? You understand? So those persons who were who will be called, also because of where they are on social media, can also invite ideas and views from their colleagues and supporters that we want to send a communique to the president or the government. Bring your views first. What are the things that are broken? And two, how should they be fixed? When should they be fixed? When should they be delivered? These are but just a few questions that you can ask. And you'll be amazed. Previously, we called people to meet at Sinche, for example, at huge cost to us. But if, with all due respect, whatever they decided were effective, we may have had very little things broken by now. It's obvious that it didn't work. In any case, with all due respect, so most of the people that were invited were the very people who have been either in government or in the helm of affairs. And we are complaining about the fact that those things didn't work.
So how then will this suggestion that you are coming up with in terms of having a dialogue, how will it work then if in the past we've had that sort of consultative process and it hasn't worked?
You see, the difference is that in the past, people were handpicked with ideas that they have always implemented and we say they have failed. This time, quite a large number of them are even unknown or unseen, but they exist, they are Ghanaians. From all walks of life, everybody is talking about the things that are affecting them personally. So the very there could be some things that the government may not have even adverted
their minds to.
These people will bring them out. But more importantly, the solutions and recommendations. For me, that is key. I mean, when the president in 2017 said, be citizens, not spectator, I added that you can be citizens by active spectator. Because perhaps, are you an Arsenal fan?
Yeah, how do you know?
I'm asking. Because if I'm sure if you had spectators at the stadium the last time, you would have done all of us proud. Then we've gotten Trinity in the UK. So spectators who are active is also very important. So not mere citizens, but citizens, active spectators. And that is exactly what I think the people are doing now. And so it's important that we extend a hand to them. Come, let us reason together. We have heard views from various individuals. Can you synchronize them? Because a lot of them may be related to one thing, but it could be about 100 points.
Yeah.
You can merge them, consolidate them into, say, 1 point. You merge another aspect about roads, consolidate them, and then we move on. Obviously, one very serious matter is road accident.
Yeah.
And a lot, about 80% of it on the Kumasi Road. And at a particular stretch of the road, almost every time, and just February alone, the last statistics, even April, just last April, over 200 people died through road accidents alone. So the point is, what can we do, I mean, to at least make that stretch? And in most cases, where on the Kumasi Road is dualized, you hardly hear of accident. Yeah. But previously, there was a place called, the old road to Chebi.
Yeah.
I've forgotten, is it a Suya or something? I've just forgotten. There used to be a lot of accident when we were little. And people even attributed it to
some
deities that wanted blood and so on. Since they diverted the road, and now you branch to Chebi and here. Just last time I used the road. It's fantastic road. But you hardly hear of accidents again around that area. Have the gods finally been sufficiently fed with blood?
The gods are not to blame.
No, they are not to blame. It is just the fact that certain parts of the road, just last week, a gentleman and his daughter from Kumasi just hit around the Asafu area. And so we have to at least prioritize some of these things. A lot have been done. Of course, you cannot still discuss this thing without the COVID angle. It is very important that even we as individuals, and individuals doing their own private jobs, sometimes you ask yourself, am I getting the income that I used to get in 2018, 2019? No. Some people used to import a lot from elsewhere because of COVID. You cannot even travel. There are travel bans. Yeah. Hotel and the hospitality industry hardly hit. And even the airport, you get to the airport, air conditioning should be on. All the facilities should be on. And yet, you cannot even use it sufficiently. So I think when we put all this together, the good thing about this is that, and somebody gave an analogy last week at a meeting that I was part of, that when you invite people to bring ideas and they add recommendations and you are the one to implement, when the benefits are accruing, it will inure to you alone. People will even forget that it was Honorable Ayuko Oto who made that suggestion. But it was Madam who implemented it. So it's the same as football. People will struggle, make sure that they are not scored, but the person who scored the other side is usually the one who is healed more than any other person. Yeah, yeah. So this, the ultimate beneficiary of this whole process will be the government, okay, or the president in particular.
Okay. I think that the stretch of road you're talking about was the Potrasi.
Potrasi, fantastic. Yes.
Place. So I'd move to, you want to respond. I know you want to respond. But before you respond, I'll move to, I'll stay on you. You're talking about inviting the people for a dialogue and them synchronizing their thoughts because there could be different strands and all that. But they're saying they want to demonstrate. They want to go on a protest. That's one thing that has come up in this past week. And you know what subsequently happened, the police, because you need to give notice under the Public Order Act and all that. And the police or the state has sought an order of prohibition to restrain them from going on this particular demonstration. So how then do you, isn't it one of the ways that people express their dissatisfaction in the system that we have? And what do you make of this whole process?
Well, I'm not against people. Demonstrations can be done many forms. An individual can just write his grievances. And it's not as if demonstrations should always be about declarations about dissatisfaction. It can even be about satisfaction. You're just demonstrating your thoughts and so on. It can even just be the group of people assembling at a place and just voicing out. But usually, what ends with such demonstrations are a presentation of the views and the thoughts and the very things they want to hear. They usually present it to the government, even if it's about the judiciary. They will still send a copy to the government or government representative, to parliament. So I'm saying that while that is good, and I strongly believe that if they had been invited, I understand there have been some invitations.
Yes, there have been some invitations.
Yeah, in a limit. It's possible that if those who were invited are satisfied or were satisfied with the invitation and the outcome, they will be able to get others to also understand that the ultimate goal is to get things done or to use their effects. We have sought, and the problem is if they don't also seek the views of the rank and file, and it's so easy because it's social media. They will just come and just paste it on your Facebook wall or your other sources of receipt of information and just go away. But if you don't also seek it, there have been also previous experiences where leaders had been able to get on the side of other leaders, let's say the government, and people have not been satisfied. I saw one quote from Franklin, that they should not be like the previous one where some leaders were given badges and other, you call it bandages, and it ended there. This is going to go far. But if people see that their views have been taken into consideration, steps are being taken. I think even if they were not personally around the table, they will be satisfied that at least something is being done. And at the same time, it's possible that things that have already been done, but the government hasn't communicated it clearly. So they say that, let's say, fix the Nsawom Suhum Road. You see gravels and other construction material being there since 2007 when President Kufuor was around. They are still there now. Usually, occasionally, you see part of it being chipped off and then constructing part of the road. This road doesn't, but a lot of accidents are also occurring at that side. And one example that somebody gave, that when you see how even trees or shrubs are growing on those gravels, it even tells you how fertile our land is.
Yeah.
If gravels that have been piled up for construction, road construction, are now able to accommodate trees and shrubs to grow, it also tells you that if we push the policy of growing this and growing that, some of us have gone into farming, and we are doing it. And so it's possible that, especially the soft policies, the digitalization and so, yes, we have digitalization, but do people understand the ultimate benefit that will near to them as a result? So when you explain, when I'm talking about armed robbery, it's possible that if this digitalization exercise is completed, it may resolve it, because the moment, for example, even road accident and people hit and running, the moment they hit, your name is keyed into a facility which should be handheld by all some officials that are designated, you'll be caught. So that, and now you see the effect of the cameras, the street cameras. We see on the spot vehicles that are hitting at this because of failure to obey road traffic
regulations.
When people know that when they commit offenses or they engage in vices, they will be caught. It is the best way, somebody says, better to highlight the enforcement. You see, the prevention of offenses and crime and wrongdoing than mere enforcement. So the point is, if they had been invited earlier and there had been satisfaction with it,
it could have been even
because they ultimately they are going to tell the government what they think. And this time, usually, it's on paper.
Okay.
So I think there should be continuous
engagement.
Just to conclude, the Galamse one, and it's Yusuf Hussein was the previous minister in the NDC government. Quite a number of stakeholders who may have not even supported the NPP were there. And I think we should throw it out to not just even the personalities leading this or who are part of it, to the whole of the country. And this time, maybe not at International Conference Center or some glamorous facility. It can even be just a Tema station. Invite people, let them come. Come and tell us. Yes, a proper town hall. Come and tell us what you think. But we should also always add about our recommendation, because we always have them. You understand? Yeah, that's
all
what
right.
I think.
All right. Very well. Honorable Ikoto, I come to you now. The people say they want to demonstrate. They notify the police in accordance with the Public Order Act of 1994 that they intended to hold a demonstration or a procession on May 9th. And they gave the reasons, the significance of May 9th, the 26th anniversary of Kumi Perko, also commemorating the May 9th disaster that we had in 2001 or so, I believe, and all that. And they stated specifically what they were protesting about, or the rising cost of living, unemployment, and all those things that we've talked about. Then the state goes to court to basically there's some engagement with the conveners and the leaders and all that. Then the police insist that there is a ban on public gatherings, and that because of the COVID-19 situation, they cannot and ensure the safety of the public. It could lead to a spike in the cases and all that. So they go to court via an ex parte application and secure a court order to prohibit them from going on the procession. What do you make of that? Is that a fair way of dealing? Because there are people who are arguing that, first and foremost, it's even unfair for the state to go by virtue of an ex parte application, especially in relation to the Public Order Act, because there's been a previous decision in the past which says that to do that is essentially unfair, and so courts should not generally allow such things. What do you make of that?
Well, thank you. It is true. If I was going to comment on that fact, that indeed, I do recall that there was a ruling that it would be better to always put it on notice to the intended demonstrators, so that at least their voices will be heard. But it does not change the rules, because the rule says you can also apply ex parte.
For 10 days.
for 10 days. So that creates a little difficulty, because if the rules are there, which permit you to do...
To do something.
Something, you know, of course, then you can take advantage of the rule. That's number one. Number two, as for the right to demonstrate, I think it is there. The NPP went to Supreme Court to say that we don't need any police permit.
NPP IGP.
Allow us to go and do our own demonstration. And they were the Supreme Court upheld that... arguments for them, and therefore the right to demonstrate is there. I mean, anybody can demonstrate, but within the context in which we find ourselves, if the police have recently gone to arrest some people at the embassy something,
Christ embassy or something,
gathering, and then the same police say, oh, go and demonstrate, you know, that will be double standards.
But the argument has been, in terms of the double standards, the argument some are making is that in just a few months ago in December, we organized the general election. The police were looking on. There were health walks, as they were called, because we weren't doing large gatherings. So they weren't called rallies. So health walks and things of that sort. And the police were in Ghana. They looked on and those things happened. So how then do you reconcile that? We had COVID then too. Yeah. How do you reconcile that with what we are seeing today, that all of a sudden now we are realizing that there's COVID and we should not allow people to congregate in large numbers?
Well, we all know COVID rises and falls. So there are periods that they will tell you that the numbers are going up, and so you need to wrap up and do a few things. So I think we are within that period where we are being constantly reminded that we should take our COVID protocol seriously. And government is saying, even allowing the police or directing the police to ensure that these things don't take place. So sure, I mean, the election thing is a different ball game altogether, because a constitutional mandate says that you can only stay there for 4 years. And so getting to the end of the 4 years, elections ought to be organized. So it becomes a deep issue. Are you going to say that there's a constitutional crisis and that the president should continue and his government should continue and all that? You know, those things came to the fore. They were also discussed, that it shouldn't happen. Whatever it is, we should make the point of trying to hold the elections and then clear it. So it's the same, COVID pandemic, which appears to have affected whatever it is. But I don't necessarily think that they just do not want. Like my good friend was saying, upon saying, if you want to engage them, then that is an opportunity for you to rather go sit down and talk instead of, because anybody can take advantage of a large gathering. I remember the Kumi Preku, where you saw the number of people that were
showed up,
engaged in the streets, because already there are a few frustrations here and there. The numbers would be too huge, and that could lead to any expiry effect of this pandemic going, So so far, so good. Let's see what happens within, if it's the next party and it's only 10 days, let's see what happens within the 10 days. We're able to have some dialogue and to let them understand that maybe there's no need for it. But if they want to really go and demonstrate, then the pandemic will allow. I don't see anything wrong. I remember there was one time President Mills, the police had tried to stop some people from going on to them. Say, oh, why? Let them go.
Let them go, yeah.
Constitutional, just let them go and demonstrate. how many hours, and that's it. You know, let them go and say their say. You know, so I believe the president would not insist that they shouldn't, if all things being equal.
Mm.
I'm sure he himself led the Democratic Kumuk Preku demonstration.
95,
yeah. We allowed them to go and demonstrate.
But then, Honorable, what do you make of the fact that the people are saying that the executive instrument that specifically bans or prohibits large gatherings has expired, and there's no, we know there's the Imposition of Restrictions Act, but the Imposition of Restrictions Act gives the president the power to issue executive instruments to do specific things. And we've seen it in the onset of COVID. There were EIs that were enacted or were issued by the president to restrict public gatherings and things of that sort. And you're saying that as of now, the EI 395, which was cited or by the police or which is being put out there as being in existence, has lapsed. And so there's no ban, according to them, in terms of public gatherings. How do we respond to that?
Well, if that is the position, then they are right, and which is the more reason why they can go to court.
So but may I, sorry, Honorable, because there is actually an EI.
Okay.
Yes. EI 135. Which is dated 30th April 2021.
EI?
135. Yes. Pardon? No, no, I'm not talking about what they found. I'm responding to the allegation.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that in, as a matter of fact, there is an existing EI 135.
Okay.
They've gone to the Supreme Court and have attached as exhibits the fact that the application, the one they went to, the court with by way of the application, which was granted, had expired.
Okay. No, but I'm not talking. I'm not actually talking about. I haven't even seen the application, but I'm talking about the. I'm just trying to respond to the whether or not as at 30th, or if you like 1st May,
there was an EI.
There was an EI. There is an there is actually one which is EI 135. Perhaps the police may not have adverted the amount or didn't know. But that is not what I'm saying. I'm saying that for our current purpose.
What does it say for the purpose?
Oh, well, it says EI 135, Executive Instrument EI 135, Imposition of Restrictions, to brackets, Coronavirus Disease, to brackets, COVID-19 Pandemic, number 18, Instrument 2021. It's quite long. Whereas by Declaration of Public Health Emergency, Coronavirus Disease, COVID-19, Pandemic Instrument 2020, EI 61, the minister responsible for health, having recognized the threats of the coronavirus disease, COVID-19 pandemic, to life and health, and its potential to escalate and cause danger to the life and health of people living in Ghana, exercise the powers conferred on the minister under Section 169 and 170 of the Public Health Act 2012, at 851, and declared a public health emergency. I will jump to the relevant clause. It says, whereas pursuant to Section 41 of the Imposition of Restrictions Act 2020, Act 1012, the restrictions imposed under the Imposition of Restriction Coronavirus Disease COVID-19 Pandemic, number 17, Instrument 2021, EI 37, were to be enforced for a period of not more than 3 months, whereas the three month period has lapsed on Friday, 30th April 2021, whereas pursuant to Section 42B of the Imposition of Restrictions Act 2020, Act 1012, the duration of the restrictions imposed under the Imposition of Restriction Coronavirus Disease COVID-19 Pandemic Number 17 Instrument 2021 EI 37 May, where the exigencies of the situation require, be extended for not more than 1 month at a time, and in any event, for not more than 3 months, and whereas the president is satisfied that the exigencies of the situation require that the duration of the restrictions imposed under the Imposition of Restrictions, coronavirus pandemic, and all that. Now, therefore, in exercise of the power conferred on the president under subsection 2 of section 4 of the Imposition of Restrictions Act 2020, Act 1012, this instrument is made the 29th day of April 2021. extension of restriction. The restrictions imposed under the imposition of restrictions instrument 20 EI 37 is hereby extended for 1 month. Review, 1 month. Where the exigencies of the situation require, the duration of the restriction specified under paragraph 1 may be varied. In accordance with section 2 of section 4 of Imposition of Restriction Act 2020-10-12. Signed, Nana Adodankwa, Ado, President.
And this Republic was on the 29th?
And gazetted on 30th April 2021.
Okay. So it was made on the 29th and then gazetted on 30th
April
2021.
Yeah, that's why I premised it by saying that if that is their case, then of course they could go to court. Mm. But if, you know, but the other issue still remains because under the Public
Order Act,
the police can always also decide whether or not, you know, they can afford due protection and if for any reason they want to
go They can ask you to put it on another date.
So all those things should come into play. We should take everything into consideration and blame it on COVID.
Madam wants to respond, right?
Just a few issues. Say that. I mean, you know, thanks to COVID, because but you see, the police, this is their stock in trade. This is not the first time that the police have tried to stop a demonstration that goes against a certain government. This is their stock in trade. They will find all means and ways and means. And this time, yes, the law is on their side. And this is where we say the law is on us.
Mm. Oh, is it?
I mean, the COVID, the pandemic is a convenient excuse. Huh? And the president can... the exigencies of the time, and it's at the will and the purposes of the president, and it is put into law. I mean, you see, but the people know how they feel, and the police have the law on their side, and maybe the law will prevail.
Mm.
But the time will surely come, and if the want and the expression, the want to vent, is not directed properly. You know, there is not directed properly. It may go in a direction that we don't want. Mm. And so I think that the opportunity to vent must be made and made safe.
Yeah.
Because when we wanted to have political rallies, we found the exigent enough for the health walks. When we wanted to do health walks, we found it possible to do health walks. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
We must make it possible for Fix the Country to have that health walk.
Yeah.
Because it is an opportunity to vent and let it out. Because there may be those Ghanaians who say that, well, now you've gone on demonstration and you vented, so let us have our peace.
Mm.
And you may have quite a few of Ghanaians, few Ghanaians who feel that way.
Mm, yeah.
You understand? But if you don't allow them to vent, those Ghanaians who would have said that, oh, okay, now you've had your say and whatever, will probably then begin to join. So I think that, you know, they should be, and the government must make it possible for the young people in the, maybe not so young because I'll join that demonstration, you know, to allow us to go out in a safe manner and vent.
And vent
let us put our mask on. Let us keep the social distancing. Do it in such a way and press upon the organizers that, look, we are allowing you to do this, but be aware of that the COVID is still raging. There could be a third wave.
Mm-hmm.
It could be, you know, you could be the victim. It doesn't matter how young you are, how healthy you are. You could be dead in the next minute. So, you know, if you love your country so much and you love the people in the country so much, make sure that this is done in a safe manner. Mm-hmm. Because we don't know when the pandemic is going away. We don't know when... it's not going anywhere soon, you know, at all. And so, but we are living.
Mm.
And we are living with bad roads. We are living with doom. So this one, intermittent, what are they calling it now? Intermittent power supply.
Yeah, it has no tree name. It has no tree name.
I mean, look, it was by any other name, but you know, Berkeley. I mean, look, I work in a facility where we have generators that as soon as the lights go on, but look, the lights are going off on and on and on. Even our generators are confused. No, but because I mean, it is ridiculous. You know, it's happening everywhere. Dawn, the lights were off. I woke up to. I said, "Oh, you know, Sakumono. At least I can tell you in Sakumono, it was off from about 1 a.m. to
yeah, it was off.
No, but it was off. So you know, the lights are off. You know, our children want shoes. We can't afford it. You know.
Honorable Ikoti is looking at my dad.
Once fuel goes up, every single thing in the country is affected.
It's every single thing. And you,
the transportation is going up. 40%.
Yes. Yeah. So, you see, let us go and vent. Let us go and vent. Because if you don't let us go and vent, the kind of implosion.
No,
ventilation is good.
We beg you, we don't need any implosion.
Ventilation is good.
We don't need implosion
in the country.
You see, we don't want implosion.
Yeah.
But when people are frustrated,
yeah, it could lead to other things.
Yeah. And it's just out of frustration. And people, look, we don't have a Ghanaian dream as it is now.
We don't.
Tell me what it is, because I want a dream. I want a dream. I want something that I can tell my children, that this is it, and that this country is the best place to be, and that being born here was not by accident, and that there's a purposeful reason to be here and be happy. We should make Ghana, that should be the aim of every government, to make Ghana the happiest place, you know, for Ghanaians to live. If at this moment we don't feel it, then as a government, you are not fulfilling your purpose. You know, we put you there to work for us. Ghana must work for us. It must work for us. And so because it's not working, that's why we're asking you to fix it. If it was working, really, we can't ask you to fix something that is working. And we don't feel like it is working. So we said, fix it, you know. And come, let us give expression to that frustration. Let us go on the streets.
Okay, let's go on the streets. That's Madam Susan Edouamankwa. And we've been, if you've been hearing, there's a gentleman who's been interjecting here and there. We've been joined by our resident latecomer.
Yes.
Lawyer Ni Kpakposamwa Addo, who came in and just started talking. So, I accept it proudly. Nipa, you've heard the discussions we're having, but quickly, I have just received an update, a press update on the injunction issued by the Fix the Country supporters. And they're saying, as you may have heard, yesterday, the 6th of May, okay, so this must have been a few days ago, the police obtained an order prohibiting us from exercising our rights under the 1992 Constitution to embark on the planned May 9 protest. The order was granted to the police despite an existing decision by a judge of the Court of Appeal saying that the police cannot seek nor obtain an order to prohibit a protest without notifying the organizers. Earlier today, our lawyers working through the night filed an application at the Supreme Court seeking to set aside the defective order made by the High Court judge. It was our hope that in view of the urgency of the matter and having regard to the grave injustice caused, that extraordinary measures will be taken to expedite the hearing of the matter so as to enable us proceed with the protest on Sunday, May 9th. However, we have just received news that the Supreme Court has fixed the hearing for 8th June 2021. We are naturally disappointed by this decision, but we continue to place our faith in the courts. As a result, we shall at the earliest opportunity file an application for abridgment of time with the hope that the court will hear the matter at an earlier date. We shall update you in a few hours on our next course of action regarding the protest, and that's the substance of it. So
Good.
Listening to what we've been talking about, what then is your reaction to this in particular? The fact that, and Lawyer Pong cited the EI and all that. So what do you make of this whole court order, EI, Supreme Court, 8th June and
so
all
let's
that?
Let's look at this from the legal point of view first. What's the structure? No. The constitutional structure is that everyone has a constitutional right to demonstrate. Yeah. That's one. That constitutional right is not unfettered to the extent that you still have to make recourse to statutory provisions that are there to protect the rights as against others, the rights of others as well. And that's why we have the Public Order Act. But let's clear this perception. You do not need the permission of the police to go on demonstration. That issue has been settled. You understand? What you need to do is to notify them.
Yes.
If they feel that they cannot provide the...
they have to go to court.
They have to go to court. Now, there's a court decision, a high court decision, that is clear that they cannot do this ex parte because they used to do this at the circuit court. They will go to the circuit court and go and obtain this order ex parte and then serve it on you to prevent you from going on the demonstration.
Ex parte, just so for our listeners...
Without notice to you. So... You serve them with a notice. Let's say you have to give them about 5 clear days, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, 5 clear days,
clear days. Then they will wait the day before they go to the court, get the order, and serve it on you. The High Court was clear that was completely illegal. One, they cannot even go to the lower courts. So that issue of going to the second court to do this was out.
Yeah.
Now they go to the High Court. The issue is, if you go to the High Court, the court was the judge sat on that particular decision when he made that, was of the opinion that you need to notify the other side. Of course, there's the debate because ex parte motions are allowed and permissible under the rules of court. So it becomes a bit contentious. It is a high court decision. It is not, is of what we call persuasive value. Another high court can decide.
Yeah, the court of concurrent jurisdiction.
Can decide. And consistently, I see that the police have been getting these orders ex parte from the High Court. So it means the High Court's judge holds a different opinion. Well, they've done the lawful thing. At least it is not in the old days where they would descend on you and on the streets and beat you up. And, I think what the
they still might when you if you go.
Yeah. Oh, no, see, the difference now
in
is
recent
that
times, I think
is if you had given them the notice and they didn't go to court, they didn't have a right to touch you. Because you have notified them within the 5 days, they didn't take any legal steps to stop you. They could not beat you up. They may say that we cannot protect you. And there have been demonstrations in this country where there have been no police protection. So it is not as if they can opt not to protect you. And then you are on your own. So then you become liable for anything that happens to you vis-a-vis on the
and
streets.
Others.
And others on the streets. What I think is interesting is this... ex parte motions that they have been moving. And what they decided to do was that they met the organizers on that day and clearly distracted them. What the organizers should have kept their eye on was to put their lawyers in the various courts. That's one of the steps you take. You put your lawyers in the various courts. So when they move the application, because the application, unless it is heard in chamber, would be called. So normally when you have a hint or you are dealing with litigation and you think that your opponent potentially could be doing something ex parte, what you probably do, and I see a lot of lawyers as part of the convenience of this particular, they would have just spread themselves out in the various courts. Yes, the court complex is well over, 15 or... But you know the particular courts that they would...
Usually.
Yeah, they usually go to. That would be the criminal courts. The criminal courts are just about 2 or 3.
Your human rights.
So you position yourself in those courts. When the matter is heard or is called, you make an application to be heard. The judge would at least hear why it should not be granted ex parte. You see, so at least you have a contribution. I know they've gone to the Supreme Court, and I think they are insistent. One of the conveners who is on Facebook, Baker, is insistent that they would have this matter heard and determined so that it acts as a guide. And I like it because the Supreme Court will have an opportunity to determine, one, whether the EI that was used had expired.
The EI on the basis of which
the police went had expired at the time that they made the application so that perhaps it's an error patent on the face of it. Whether the motion could have been moved ex parte without notice to the other side,
which would also, that whatever it is, this is a this is an issue that is of national interest. So I'm sure the Supreme Court would give a reasoned decision on it, and it will guide all of us.
And just to chip in, you see, I hardly go for S Party unless there's no other.
It's because absolutely necessary.
The law is very clear that once you serve the process on the other party.
No, you see, sometimes I can understand the police because these convenience were basically on Facebook.
Yeah.
You can see them. So how do you serve them?
Oh, well, now we allow Facebook service and WhatsApp. Yeah, WhatsApp service.
What I would think that the authorities could be doing, the police service has a legal department.
Yes, yes.
And this one was led by the Attorney General's Department. They can put this on notice. At least when it's on notice.
That's right.
That also is a prohibitive measure and can ask for interim orders pending the hearing of the... you see, let the state not make it look like there's something to hide. I know that Godfred is not one who is afraid to take you on when it comes to the court. We've all been praising him as one who has, you know... And recently he did this, having a court sit on a Sunday so that the rights of the accused persons will be respected. I think we can elevate this. I think I would probably, one after the program, I would send him a message that, look, let it not be that the state is seen to be hiding anything. Engage the people. If there's the need, the state feels that because of the COVID, such demonstrations should not be allowed, the state should be in court, have the arguments made, let the court make a reasoned decision, and let's all be guided.
But Nini, I think also that, you see, if he had been served, you know, this is just 10 days.
Yes.
Usually, it will be almost between 7 days to about 14 days or 10 days for the application, the other side to be heard. So even after the 10 days, the state may have to repeat the application on notice.
Precisely.
But I'm very delighted that it's gone to the Supreme Court.
Yes.
The Supreme Court will determine with finality,
Precisely.
whether to affirm the decision of Justice James J, who
in the
High Court, or the recent ones that are coming up, that S parties are allowed in such circumstances.
Yes.
At the end of the day, when the Supreme Court makes that determination, one, it may be impossible for people to just give 5 days notice to the police and follow up with it, because the application itself, at least the 3 clear days will take you beyond 6 days if weekends come in and so on. But those like the apprehension that you are expressing, that people may think that somebody has something to hide, will not be so. Fortunately, the 10 days will be over soon, and I think the Attorney General would then have to either repeat it, or because of the application before the Supreme Court, they may rather want to deal with it there in a manner that will let the whole nation also understand that it is not that people have something to hide.
Exactly.
Because under Section 2 of the Public Order Act, the police have a responsibility to take such steps as are reasonably necessary in any public place.
Yes.
Assist in proper conduct of special event by directing routes.
Yes.
So even though you don't need their permission, they have to be there to direct routes of such event to prevent obstruction of pedestrians or vehicular traffic.
Protect the rights of others.
To disperse crowds at any special event where there has been reasonable grounds to believe. That's not my favorite part anyway. But so they have this responsibility under the Act. Whether in fact, the police cannot even then leave you, whether they agree with you or not, and you decide to go.
Yes.
They are still imposed with a duty to still come to the street.
But practically, it has happened in some demonstrations where the police have just left the demonstrators to do what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
My point is that legally, we need to have a clear ruling by the court.
We must commend those who have gone to the Supreme Court.
We are guided
as
to whether, because the ex parte may be necessary sometimes for national security purposes.
That's right.
You do not know the intention of the persons. They may, but if you are not guided, there must be a balance. So I would not be one to say that, look, the police should not be allowed in certain circumstances
to apply for,
especially when you have a pandemic. Clearly, this is not one that we can play with, because one event can be what they call the super spreader.
And they were not at the health works. The health works were not super spreader.
Because the demonstration is a political one, we all are a bit touchy about the fact that there must be allowed. So even if you might want to do it, and the police may say, okay, do it over a number of days. So each day spread we can out. Spread it out. Mm. We can have maybe 100, 200, 300 spread out. Then the next day, there must be ways of allowing the individual citizens to exercise their rights at the same time maintaining law and order. We must have a balance.
I agree. Yes.
We must definitely have a balance. But there seems to be this creeping attitude of the police since the 7th of January, ex parte all the time to prevent.
Someone is saying on WhatsApp that you've not explained, we are not explaining the ex parte to
us. Sorry. The ex parte is simply mean that they went to court without notice to the other side.
Mm.
So the state went to court on behalf of the police.
What's the opposite? Get an order. I think you should give the opposite.
Yeah.
That is on notice.
The opposite being that if the state had gone to court notice and served the other side, then it meant that both sides would be in court to make the argument.
Yeah.
Now, Baker is insisting that they have gone to court. They've got the 8th of June. They are going to file an application for abridgment of time to have the matter heard. It's good. I even think that beyond the Supreme Court, they should go to the High Court and fight the application that was filed by the police. And show why that application was brought in bad faith or whatever reason that they give. The High Court has a duty to also hear them on notice and make a determination. Mm. So that once the High Court makes the determination, then they may be free to do their demonstration. And once you are free to do your demonstration, it means the police cannot interfere anymore. What they can do is to provide you with the needed security to allow you to
direct you as
to do your demonstration. Mm. And I think that the state, especially President Danado, has a responsibility because he is known for Kumi Preko.
Yes. So
the founders of these demonstrations, you cannot be seen or should not be seen to be preventing demonstrations under your time. It doesn't help.
So you're still listening to us here on the forum, and we're wrapping up this conversation because there are other things we need to talk about. Madam Susan, you have some fans here. Chumdaku is saying, Madam Susan, I love your objective criticism, but please, it's not a hopeless situation. We all have a stake in our country's development. It's true that leadership has a major role, but citizens must subject themselves to leadership and not be rebellious. Hashtag let's fix it together. Someone is asking a specific question to the lawyer. I believe he sent it at the time that Lawyer Pong was talking. Okay. Shabo Shabo is saying, ask the lawyer, people are being paid every month to solve problems. So if problems are raised and these people can't find solutions to them, then why do we still pay them and to the extent of still holding their positions?
So if they are politicians, vote them out.
If they are politicians, vote them out. Okay. All right. Someone is also saying on, I'll come to you shortly. Someone is also saying on WhatsApp that, and I think it's still in relation to Madam Susan about the Ghanaian dream. He's saying the Ghanaian dream is to go live the American dream.
It's funny.
This is probably very true.
Yeah. And so we're wrapping up. Final comments from everyone. But Madam Susan, you talked about the fact that fix it, there are problems, all the problems that we've mentioned. But isn't it also true that the government is doing certain things? There's one district, one factory, there's free SHS. No, wait and hear my point. I know you respond. The government has initiated in the past 4 years, has initiated planting for food and jobs, NAPCO, and all those things. There are specific interventions that this government has put in place, which is clear, it's obvious for everyone to see. So within the context of let's fix it or fix the country, is it fair? And it goes back to an earlier question that I asked, and I think I don't know if I asked Honorable Aiko too, about the fact that this is coming in the immediate aftermath of an election which this government has won. So how do we situate this particular agitation?
I mean,
just 1 minute.
I hesitate to say that one district, one farm, one factory, and all those it's sloganeering. I mean, really, I said, look, this is the president who said that he was putting his presidency on the line for Kalamsey.
Yes.
What have we seen?
And he won the election in the aftermath of saying that.
Because I've told you why he won the election. Not because we like him. I mean, we won the election because we didn't have a choice. And when...
I'm hurt. We had a choice.
There were 11 others.
We just wanted to retire the man honorably.
When Lawyer Paul said that there were 10 other people on the ballot sheet, look, as a people, What we have lost is our audacity to do things in a new way. I always say that what Nkrumah gave us was not the dam and the fine things that we see, you understand? But he gave us the audacity for us to lift ourselves and say that
had the audacity to be on the ballot paper.
We were audacious enough to take leads of faith in certain directions. Unfortunately, we've lost that. Over the period, we have lost it. It has eaten at our self-esteem, and we become a people who feel people must do things for us.
Mm.
And so when it comes to this 12 people, to make that leap of faith, to move away from the two, it's like being in a bad marriage and you want to get out, but you look out there, you're like, oh, okay. And it's not because the marriage is good, it's just that
you are too afraid.
And we are too afraid. You understand? We have lost that audacity where we were. We are Ghanaians and we're super Africans. We were super Africans at the time. We thought we could take on the world, and we did. But we have lost it over the period. And so you have 12 people, but we are like, these two devils. Hey, okay, this CCC.
But there was that. To be fair, there was an electric shock.
Electric shock.
The NPP may have won, but they lost.
Mm.
They know they lost. When you move from a million and you come down like that, when you have 63 plus seats and you come at par, you lost. Mm. You know they know they lost. Mm. They know they lost. So they may have won. It looks obvious that they won, but they didn't. I mean, there's a lot more I could say about, especially this, I'm putting my presidency on the line for Kalamse. What does it mean? It was worthless. It was totally worthless. You understand?
No, it means vote for me or vote against me if I do not solve the Kalamse. No, I'm just...
The Kalamse, look at our rivers. I look at our rivers and I weep. Mm. Your heart just bleeds, and somebody put his presidency on the line. Really?
But then he won the election.
It doesn't
change.
We're nice.
Quickly, Honorable Ayuko, to one minute wrap up of on this discussion.
Well, I have said that it's not a bad idea for people to express their views. I wouldn't change that. You have a right. Okay. I mean, the president himself said you have to be citizens
and not spectators.
So it's okay, provided it is being done with good faith, you know, and taking into account with the context within which these things are happening, you know, because we there was peace for four solid years. The Galamse was there, and I like to remind her that whilst the president was putting his presidency on the line, another was going about saying that if they jail you because of Galamse, I will release you. Go ahead and do Galamse. She was in this country. She didn't say anything.
You didn't hear me. Because those are two different
things. You were not loud enough.
You did not hear me. So
if I didn't hear you, you cannot blame the president who said, I put my presence on and I'm doing everything possible to ensure that we bring this thing to a close. And yet others were encouraging them and telling them, to the extent that they felt so emboldened that they went and bought pickups to give to that.
And they actually voted against the one who was doing it.
We lost in most of those places. You understand? So I don't think it's that easy to just say it was sluganary and really nothing happened. He did his beat. He did his beat, what he could do. And it's now become clear that if you go to a power treatment source and you see that what is being treated is clear. Nobody will tell you that the thing has gotten to a state that you have to do everything that is necessary to stop it.
Just a second. I just want to keep this in about the fact that, you see, when you are in your second term, you rule a little differently. You see, you can see that the president is less shackled when it comes to having to please everybody. Mm-hmm. I think that you can see that the fight, you look out for the fight against Galamsey now.
Mm-hmm.
It is going to be a bit different. Now, there's going to be a more ruthless edge towards the fight because he is not bound by any expectation, you see,
of being voted for again anymore.
So give him, I think that I like what I'm seeing with this second phase of the fight, especially on the river.
Along the banks of the river.
The second phase
is an increased force of 400.
Mm.
I do have some clients in the mining industry, so I get my feelings of the ground that there seems to be a new... And this new, I must commend whoever the new commander is. I hear he's virtually incorruptible. That's the information I'm getting from the ground. So I think that this new one, and I understand the instructions are clear. The forces that are being used and everything is different. So I think the president in the second term may be able to do more without having to feel that he needs to please his party,
So he's fixing it.
Not fixing it per se, but he is. He's
taking steps.
In the second term,
he's less shackled.
That's the first one. My only thing about, and just in respect of the demonstrations, is there must be a more deliberate attempt by the government to see to it that citizens are able to express themselves. I am unhappy this week, especially when you are having journalists, especially the senior ones like Mr. Smart of Angel FM. He's not the only one. Another sports journalist also expressed support with the Fix the
Country Now movement. Yeah.
And they come under threat. There's a graphic reporter as well. Journalists do not feel safe in this country as at present to be able to do their jobs. If a journalist, a senior journalist on a morning show, is taking off the air and he openly comes to say that his own owner has received calls from senior government officials, from the GRE, from other places, threatening that if he's maintained on the air, and this is an interview he gave to Paul Adomochi, it's on Facebook. I'm not making this up. The government must necessarily give expression to its posture or its the image that it is a tolerant government because this tag of intolerance is not just now becoming one that is people are just saying that the government is intolerant. It is actually finding expression. You see, it is actually becoming a reality. And if you're not careful, if these voices that are supposed to be the voice of the voiceless are being silenced, and being silenced in an open way, we would develop a culture where another government will come and think that it is the normal thing to do. That when you are in power, you can use whatever state apparatus to be able to say, today it may be the NDC because it is in the opposition. And not just the NDC, independent voices. That is for me is the worry. If the NPP comes into opposition and then needs the platforms and the voices and civil society to be able to speak, it would have created a culture where if a party is in power, it believes that it is the right thing to do. Journalists should not at any time in our country feel that they must not be able to do their jobs independently. It is a dangerous trend.
It's a dangerous trend.
I mean, I think the point about the government is even in the process of being formed. But I think you may not be able to take it too much away from the people because people see it as almost a continuum.
Yeah.
Because substantial number of the ministers have been retained. In fact, not just retained, but in the same ministry. Some of them were even quote-unquote caretakers. So people, we have the same president, the same vice president, Minister for Trade, Communication, Information, and what have you, quite a large number. Those who are not in the same ministries are in a different ministry and so on. So people really don't see a difference or, if you like, a truncated
government now being formed.
You understand? So that is, there should be a balance anyway. Even though legally, Otherwise, then the minister shouldn't have even gone to parliament for vetting.
But
legally and constitutionally, there is a different government, a new government.
Yeah.
But in reality,
it's the same.
It's almost the same. And this is why people really don't see. If it had been Nick Papo's best man, our own President Mahama, who is the, people would have given it to him that, oh, he was away for 4 years.
And now he's coming.
President Nanadu was actually not away. In fact, on the 7th in the morning that he should have gone, he still performed executive functions. So we need to make that balance.
So should he, is he fixing it or he has to fix it?
See, when it comes to, I can give maybe itemized list of these things. Galamsey, I'm from Oda. And when you see how the brim has become, look, when it started, the fixing of the Galamsey thing started. I was there. The color, now that is how you even have to call it, was changing. It was changing. And I took pictures. I have all. Then just later, it became worse than how it was before we started. So there was an effort. And it was yielding fruit. And then eventually, but the problem also that I'm seeing now is, if you take the Brim River, for example, in Oda itself, there is no Galamsey going on. It used to be a half of a diamond. So you have to go to the source. And the Brim doesn't have just one source. There are tributaries that join from Nsanwem and so on to Adonkro. No, when you come to the Akwetia area, so they have, but you see the Brim here like clay or like scarlet. It is not the cause of any activities at that time, at that place. You have to go to the source. And that is what I think that the people in these areas should draw the government's attention to. Otherwise, they will just come to Oda, oh, there's nobody doing Galamsey. So it will not. So because it starts from...
And let's commend those people who arrested those...
The Tiwa.
The chief and the people there did very, very well.
Yes.
And I'm happy. See, that's why I'm saying that. The president is less shackled now because I saw a statement from the Minister of Information that all those people who were arrested were not national security.
Were not, yeah.
So we want to see prosecution.
Yes, of course.
So you see that.
Even if they were.
There's a more ruthless edge towards this fight now.
And we 100% support the immediate destruction of these destructive facilities.
Yes.
But on on the point of the general, I think that there's a concern that people have expressed. But for example, if I may be permitted, some of the things that our friend Captain Smart was even saying about the Ochehini, I had been given instruction to write to the station. If you say that the Ochehini is allowing Galamsey to be done behind his palace, I have been at the palace just about a month ago to donate a copy of my book. And there's a massive construction, trying to facelift the whole place. I didn't see any gallants in the closest or even in the remote part of it. And even if this is a concern, at least channel it. It's possible that he may not have known. So that is also part of journalism. So write to the person. You have always been preferring butterflies to gold. You remember that debate that used to be very dominant, whether to allow the gold to be inside to in the ground. So that butterflies will exist. Yes, one part wanted the gold to be mined, and he wanted the butterflies because he didn't see much. In fact, and he has come out critically against the government's the new mining,
he has
the community mining.
He has
come out critically against the government. Right. Some people were surprised. This is how much the man is interested in the environment.
Allow the mining to be even started.
Yes.
He doesn't care what the law is, irrespective.
And you actually mentioned the NPP government.
Yeah.
So how do you then also turn around to put him as if in a harm's way to say that Galamsey is happening very close to his community?
The problem that we have there, simply, just a minute, is that, look, We and I always say this, that we expect a higher standard of the NPP to the NDC. I'll keep repeating that the NDC does not have the democratic credentials as the MPP.
I think this should be a quote.
No. respect.
Capture. Oh, no, but that's right.
The respect of its founding fathers when it comes to. I mean, you are talking about lawyers and what is even the record of the president? The president is a fierce
human rights. Yeah.
Human rights. He's been to court. He actually defended journalists for free in a time when we had criminal libel laws in this country. The worst journalist, okay, is better than a system where we have silence.
Yes.
Okay. That's for the standard. That's what I'm saying. That for the standard, we need to be putting such people before the Ghana Journalist Association, before the National Media Commission. Oshini can even summon him to his palace because he's a huge traditional thief. What we should not be having is that you have a journalist yanked off a station because he makes a comment that government does not find favorable.
Well, that can be said.
Because
at the end
of the day, if the pressure is being brought on the owner of the station, so imagine we have a forum like this. We are expressing our opinions. Then the next day, Doc says something that the station owner does not somebody does not like. And we come to the station the next time for the program and we hear that he's been taken off because he said something or we said something that did not like. That is a dangerous thing.
No, but that nobody supports that.
For me, as much as we have journalists, and we've been having journalists who have written, when we started in 1992, we had worse headlines and worse situations in this country. But we still went on, we still survived the system. So we expect better from this particular government. That is why I cannot make an excuse for this kind of culture that is creeping into our journalism. Mm. It's wrong.
Right. Just a quick one. Okay. I mean, you say that the NPP have better democratic
credentials
than the NDC. I think it's not that the NPP have more finesse in the menacing ways of doing things. The NDC are a little more disorganized and booga booga in the things, but yeah, the same.
But the point,
I used to go to GBC, way before the NDC, and then look, the MPP have a subtle way of sending menacing messages to the heads of the programs, etc., to take people off or not to invite people. When NPP and Prof Mills came into power, we could go and say certain things in GBC that we would not have dared to say it in the time of John Ajakum Kufo.
Yes.
The MPP have always been intolerant of views that don't favor them. It is not new. Now, they have just given it a bolder face. It is not that they don't do it. They are just giving it a bolder face.
I deliberately said it metaphorically because I have put, there's an image. And if that image is being whittled away, in the manner in which it's being whittled away, not even on a weekly basis.
No, they are showing their true colors.
On a daily
now
basis.
They don't, now they are, that
then
veneer.
It becomes a reflection, unfortunately, of the president. You understand? Because these are appointees that are having a field day with respect to these threats to these journalists. And you'll be surprised. Even female journalists are being threatened. It's wrong. I hear the Minister of Information say that yes, there are 500
TV stations, radio stations.
It's not about the number of stations.
No.
It is about the quality of journalism that is being practiced in the country.
Definitely.
So we should let the journalists be free. Other than that, we'll not just fix the country, we'll be fixing the journalists as well.
final word to Honorable Ikoti on this matter.
No, I agree. I mean, we should rather expand the frontiers of freedom. Let everybody have their say. If indeed these things are happening, you know, people are being threatened behind the scenes, people are being, you know, taking off, you know, their consoles and giving the opportunity to express themselves. That is not what the MPP stands for.
No.
I don't think so.
But I think you see, after the way the Munti 3, and they should forgive me by just referring to the case happened, where even the secretary to the company who had been dissociated himself for over 20 years or so was cited for contempt. You see, so at the same time, instead of even applying some of these ruthless facilities or cautioning and removing them, you must constantly get some editor who review these things they say. Because if not, you the director, and now people are even, when they are suing for defamation, they don't really sue the station and the editor. Yes, they add the secretary to the company, directors. Yes, I have seen one before. Really? But that is how our senior, what's the name again? Oh, the Moon Theater, he was also invited. Bram Labi.
Oh, okay. I didn't know.
He was the secretary to your company that Imani engendered the life. Yeah, so you see, they may also have a concern, but I'm saying that there is a way to go by it. You just have to caution the person. Yeah. This is the editorial policy of the institute. But it should not also be because they are criticizing government.
Yeah.
Of course, they will have a say. So we need to find that balance. Mm. Who is it that is, maybe a secretary to one of these companies. You don't even usually listen to the program. Because in the morning, you may be going to court and all that. Then the next time you hear, there is defamation suit
or contempt.
Yes. And so they should find a balance and just ensure that the people they employ and who engages, sometimes they repeat it. And now with social media, you hear these things.
Internationally.
Yes, you hear these things. And for people's reputation, you see, when you even say sorry, they say it's like taking off the feathers of the chicken.
Yeah.
Even if you're able to find all of them, you won't be sure whether this one was behind the head or the yabojise or something that you remove. Okay. So there should be that balance. But I am all for the situation where if you disagree with a journalist, the procedures are there.
Yeah.
National media in particular. Yes. As for GIJ, GJ, not all of them are members, so they are not really amenable. Right. But first, write.
Yeah.
And sometimes people don't even write to them at all. Then they start the legal process. I would have written to the company, are you aware this is what was said? If the person can retract, maybe even without apology, that is fine.
Yeah.
But tell the whole world that when you said to so-and-so, you were either mistaken or misinformed.
Mm.
That is fine. So that we have that balance also.
Okay.
Because the reason why people find it, just one quick way, the reason why people find it strange is because it's from it's an NPP government in power. It's unthinkable that in an NPP government, we would have journalists threatened.
And I think the reasons given also, that because he was on the neck of so-and-so personalities.
Yes. But the point is, he actually repeated the conversation he had had with his station owner, which has not been denied.
That's what I'm saying. That's what.
All right. Okay. So you're still listening to us here on the forum. We've spent a lot of time talking, fixing things. I think
fix the host.
So the consensus seems to be that all of us seem to be in agreement that people need to be allowed to express their rights to protest and all that, but we need to also sort of balance it out in terms of the times within which we live. But ultimately, once the matter is at the Supreme Court, we hope some finality will come, and then people still will be allowed to vent, in the sense that Madam Edua Mankwa has been suggesting that if you don't allow people and it's bottled in, it may lead to something else which we do not want. So that seems to be the general consensus that we have on this matter. We're moving on to our next conversation, which it's essentially a recreation of something that we've talked about, and I'd love to hear what our guests have to say, especially Nipapo and Loyal Paul. The issue has to do with the Wesley Girls High School and GES brouhaha, as is being referred to. The issue about a Muslim student who was not allowed, or who is not allowed, to fast because of policies or school rules, which generally prohibits fasting for health reasons and other concerns. So in relation to this issue, an Islamic scholar, Sheikh Abdullah Tubudo, has questioned why some Muslim students are prevented from observing the mandatory Islamic fast. His concerns come on the back of the report of a Wesley Girls Senior High School student prevented from fasting by the headmistress. The Muslim caucus in parliament also has described the act as unacceptable. And speaking to Assassin News, Sheikh Abdullah Tubodo explained that it is obligatory for every Muslim within the stipulated age to fast in the month of Ramadan unless there is a case of a medical condition.
Muslim fasting is a prescribed one. It has a starting date and it also has an ending date. So stopping students from fasting, I don't think it's the right way. And it will be like infringing on their rights. According to Islam, if a male or a female child matured, it is obligatory on that person to fast the month of Ramadan. But in a situation where the person cannot fast, maybe because of sickness, the Ramadan person should refund the days that he couldn't fast. A person preventing you from fasting, then we'll ask that person, why the person preventing you? Which constitution in this nation gave that person the right to prevent you from doing that fasting? That's been the question.
Some Muslim youth have also expressed their views on this particular development.
Or will from Almighty Allah. Also, it also boosts your trust and belief in the Almighty Allah. And also, it allows the rich to give alms to the poor. It allows them to give out to the poor because they've also been through that before and they know how it feels.
The reason I fast as a Muslim student is because I am a Muslim. And as a Muslim, it is duty upon us to fast during the month of Ramadan. Fasting is one of the key pillars in Islam. Just like the five daily prayers we have to observe. It is a commandment from Allah. You must do it. In school, it has no effect on my health condition or academic performances either.
So you heard the voices of some Muslim youth. Also, Executive Director of Policy Think Tank Africa Education Watch, Kofi Asari, has commended the Ghana Education Service for directing the management of Wesley Girls High School to allow Muslim students to partake in the ongoing Ramadan fast. Reports say the board of the school, along with executives from GES and the Ministry of Education, have successfully resolved the matter. Mr. Asari described this move as heartwarming.
I think it is much welcome that the GES has within days resolved an issue of religious rights in conflict with existing school rules. The issue came up just last week or so, and it has gotten to the level where the GES leadership and minister and the board of the school have successfully resolved the issue. And so it is heartwarming that the issue has been successfully resolved.
Meanwhile, Mr. Kofi Asari once again adds that a standardized code of conduct for all senior high schools should be developed to prevent micromanaging similar issues in the future.
When the Asumota issue emerged, we raised issue with the existence of various code of conduct in secondary schools. Mm. Secondary schools do have this code of conduct. Secondary schools do have this code of conduct. We have actually engaged the Ministry of Education on the need to have a standardized code of conduct for all senior high schools.
Mm.
This standardized code of conduct will be developed with and for senior high schools and their stakeholders, including the old students and the boards, so that it will be easier for the GES to coordinate the implementation of a standardized code of conduct across all schools. That, for me and for us, is the way forward, so that in the future we don't do micromanagement, or we don't always intervene every other issue relating to secondary school rule at the top level.
Finally, the Ghana Muslim Students Association has also condemned the response by the Methodist Church of Ghana for refusing to allow Muslim students to fast during Ramadan. Sharif Adam is the public relations officer of the Muslim Students Association.
Issues that have resulted into staging this particular press release is because of the counter statement that came from the Methodist Church, the leadership of the Methodist Church, and some members of Scripture Union, who are saying that government or the school should refrain from that directive. They should not work with the directive issued by GES and the Ministry of Education. is a statutory ministry issuing a statement. They should not work with that directive. First of all, we find that to be disrespectful. We find that to be against the very reason why we are fighting for this cause, because we are supposed to work together as partners. We are supposed to coexist and ensure that everybody is in harmony. So what we are calling for, one thing, only one thing, and that is it. We want it to be very clear, and it has to go down to every Ghanaian. We are calling for Muslim students to be students and Muslims.
So you've been hearing some sound bites in relation to this issue that cropped up at Wesley Girls High School in relation to some Muslim students that one student that was not allowed to fast because of the school rules and the back and forth, the GES directing that the student be allowed and all that. And this has brought back the conversation that we were having a few weeks back regarding the Rastafarian issue and dreadlocks issue, when some students were not allowed or were told to cut the dreadlocks before they were given admission or they were allowed to properly enroll in Achimota Secondary School, and the wider implications of this. So I'll begin this conversation with Madam Edouard Mankwa. Are we religiously intolerant? Are we intolerant of other religious views, given the fact that we're a majority Christian country?
Did you start with me because I have locks?
No, I didn't start.
Yeah,
no, I started with you because
not because I have
no,
locks.
No, because you're female.
Not dreads, so they are locks. Yeah. That's not other the dread.
The dread, yes.
No, you say dreadlocks. It's a certain means zero. So it's locks. We have locks.
That means you are dreaded.
We are Nazarenes, so we have locks. No, so I wish you could. I'm showing you a picture. And these girls are in Holy Child.
Yes. Holy Child Secondary School. Okay. Yeah.
So I don't think is it about that fasting? Because look, I went to secondary school.
Mm.
Going to the dining hall is compulsory.
Yes.
But eating is not.
Mm-hmm.
So you can go to the dining hall and decide that today the kinke I don't like.
Yeah.
Nobody is going to force you to eat it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a little confused because I'm beginning to... Was it about she not eating, she obeying the school rules of going to the dining hall and not eating? Or was it that I'm fasting, so I'm not going to the dining hall?
Mm-hmm.
Because those are two different things altogether.
That's right.
We were required to go to the dining hall. Dining hall was part of school activity that was compulsory. Whether you were going to eat or not, you were required to go and sit there. So I'm hard-pressed to believe that it was just about she not eating. Because, look, what is the alternative to that? Force feeding?
No.
Nobody will... we've had most... Yes. What was the force feeding? It's too much stress. And I don't know who was even going to pay attention to you. If you didn't eat in the dining hall, they said it was like, hey, your top box must be full. Mm. Or that's why you had this thing. And look, I went to a Catholic school. We have Lent. Lent is 40 days of fasting. People could choose to fast or people chose not to fast. You understand?
Wednesdays and Fridays only.
Yeah, and as a Catholic school, it was okay.
Yeah.
Nobody compelled anybody.
Which Catholic school?
I went to Holy Child. And that's why I was showing the Holy Child picture of Muslim girls in the school
wearing
their hijabs. You understand? So I think that we should look at it. I don't know the story well. But for the bits that I heard from it, and the father went there, asked the girl whether she was doing her fasting, and she said no, she had been prevented from doing it. The father got offended, wanted to pull her out of the school, but the young girl wanted to stay. Why did she want to stay? I mean, she thought the school environment was good for her, even though they were not allowing her to fast. Is it something that is the parents that are now creating?
No, but let's look at it within this context. The context is that she's a Muslim.
Yes.
under Islam, mm-hmm. she's supposed to fast when you're of age and you can.
Yes.
And there are some exceptions mm-hmm. for certain situations yeah. for health and all that. Mm. But if you can, you should. And so she wants to fast and she's not allowed so to do.
So they are force feeding her?
No, nobody said they're force feeding her, but apparently there is the assertion that in Wesley Girls High School there are appointed students on every table who report you when you don't eat at the dining hall.
I mean that, but I find that strange because I know friends who went to Wesley Girls and they deploy me when I go to the dining hall. I won't eat the dining hall food, and unless it's a new thing that has come,
that bees.
they say oh,
like Nipapo.
We don't like the food. Action box is the same, and nobody forced it. And what happened was that yeah. they shared the food among the rest of the people who wanted
but you
to
see,
eat.
The other point is that they're saying that even Christians are not allowed to fast.
It's a cross board. I will get there because I can say that as a Catholic, if I went to Wesley Girls and I said that in the 40 days of Lent I wanted to fast, would Wesley Girls say that no? Because and if they said it to me no, it's then it may be a school rule generally that you must eat. But I'm finding it a little difficult. Also, in terms of when we are going to a school or we are going to a place, do we not find the culture of the place or in the environment in which we are going to put our child or our children? Is it because we've heard Wesley Girls academic, this, and no, we must send our children to Wesley Girls? No. Look, when your child is choosing a school, do you not go and find out, okay, this school, is it just about, oh, these people, they do well, and they're
the regulation.
Huh?
Oh, they are usually
no, like but the, you, it is
like
not
that about, small
no,
one.
But it is
the
regulations. But the issue is that it is not just about the regulations. The regulations may cut across. You understand? But there are cultures in different schools. That is why somebody can immediately see a certain lady and say, "You must have gone to Holy Child," and see another one and say, "You must have gone to Motown." Oh, you must have gone because the mannerisms, the attitude to certain you.
The way they walk.
You would see it. My wife and so in
she went away.
You would see it immediately.
She must be awake.
In culture of it. Lead and so kid. It's not about the school rules. Every school has their culture, their ethos, what happens there.
So even if the student for religious purposes wants to fast during this period of Ramadan, she shouldn't be allowed simply because she is in...
That is not what I'm saying.
Okay.
I'm saying is that, one, when we are going somewhere, let's do the due diligence and see... Is this
yes, we did the due diligence.
They do the due diligence.
It's a public school.
It's a public school. Okay. It's a public school. So maybe in public school we did the due diligence.
So you
go there before.
You have
and
made them
then
already.
You have a discussion with the headmistress mm-hmm. that my understanding of this school is that this is this. But I would want to plead that this and make that argument for your child even before they go there so that we don't get this into this brouhaha. You understand? Because right now, we will get to the point where we are going to be pitting against each other. Then I don't want Muslim girls in a Catholic school. Because, you understand, why don't you go to your Muslim school and do that? Because that is where we will get to.
Yeah,
if we get to, we will get to that point where we say, look, and I, for the love of me, we will say that if you come to us, and they do it in certain countries, if you come to my school with a certain kind of name and something, okay, of course, now they are doing the general picking and things like that. But otherwise, what will happen that if you are coming to my school with a certain type of name, I would immediately decide that I'm not good. No, but it will be so, you will not even pass to get there. Nobody will tell you why. But you would know. I mean, they do it in certain countries and things
but
like that.
But is that the type of country we want to live in?
No, that's not. And we have lived peacefully. There have been Muslims going to Christian schools, and there have been a few brave Christians who go to the Muslim schools. But in the Muslim schools, do they not close on Fridays to go and pray? Do the Christians there say that no? It's a we are just It is the way we are managing it now. Yeah. We are going to be pitting each other against each other, and then some of the us who are fanatical about our religions are going to say, "What? I'm a Catholic school. We paid for those Catholic schools with our sweat," and I just say, "Why are you a Muslim coming here and saying that it's time to go to the chapel to say rosary? You are not going. It's a school event." We must also be careful that that doesn't happen in our schools. Mm-hmm. We must, look, I went to a Catholic school. Yeah. Every Wednesday, it was compulsory to go to Mass. Wednesdays and Sunday. It was compulsory to go. You could go there and fold your arms, but you had to be present. Nobody was going to force you to pray, but you had to be present because it was a school activity. Yeah. It made for discipline. It made for this. The issue about the fasting is slightly different because she has to go to the dining hall. That one is non-negotiable. She has to be in the dining hall. But as for forcing her to eat and things,
It's happened in the past. That's something that they said, that in the past there has been situations or have been situations where students who were fasting had suffered from ulcer and have died or something of that sort and affected their health and everything. And so the school has a responsibility that people, once you are in the school, you are in the care of the school. So it's their duty and responsibility to ensure that you are well fed, you are okay, you focus on your studies and all that.
So it is also then the duty of the school to say that we will be taking Muslims into our school and this is our rules. But you as a parent, can you say that when it comes to fasting, your child will be allowed to fast? But if there are any consequences to it, then you would have waived that our right. We would have waived it to you that this child in this period. And so we know.
Yeah.
That because I'm not sure that Wesley Girls and other schools are overwhelmed with Muslims, that they cannot sit with parents who of Muslim girls and say that, look, this is our rule. We want to do this. But we want you to have the freedom to practice your religion as you want. And so in this period... Please, I say that your daughter is medically fit to do this, and that if anything happens to do to her that is found to be related to the fasting, we have no.
I think that's the general
conclusion. That is the way it should be.
Yeah, that the matter was resolved, apparently resolved. That was the consensus.
not completely.
Yeah, but that was the first, I'll come to you. That was the first thing that it seemed as though they said, okay, once the parents can guarantee that they bear the responsibility, the school has no responsibility, that's fine and everything. But I'll move to Honorable Aiko and just to follow up from what Madam Edouard Mankwa said, I also went to a Catholic school, by the way, St. Augustine's College.
Action.
And
he's more Mama B.
And your mics are off, so nobody can hear you. I'm a Christian, but I'm not a Catholic. But I went to a Catholic school, and one of the things that I found interesting and was wondering, because I was young, was we had to go to Mass. I'll come to that. We had to go to Mass first and foremost. Every house had a day that you go to Mass. So maybe if you're in Kelly House, you go to Mass on Monday. Stevens will go on Tuesday and so on and so forth. And Sunday, we all have to go to Mass. It's compulsory. I mean, once you get to final year and all, you can do whatever you want. But generally speaking, you have to go because it's a school event and all that. And one of the things that I found interesting was that you had to, because I hadn't been exposed to Catholic, a Catholic church before, so I didn't know some of the things not the kneeling, but generally because I know the communion, right?
Yeah.
But I didn't know that within the Catholic setting and in the Catholic school, you had to be Catholic before you were given the communion and all that. So the first time I went, and I went to collect it and all that, obviously nothing happened, but I was subsequently oriented that this is the situation and all that. And I found, it was, even me as a Christian, I found some of the things interesting because every 6 hours she had to stay still and recite Hail Mary, the Angelus.
The Angelus, yeah.
So 6 a.m., 12 noon, and 6 p.m. and all that, which was strange to me because I didn't know what was happening. But for some reason, we knew it. So we chewed it and we would just say it in class. We'll pause class and talk about it and all that. But interestingly, so whether you're a Muslim, Buddhist, or whatever, I haven't said that. Whether you're a Muslim, Buddhist, Sikh, or whatever it is, you still had to go to mass. I found it a little problematic, but to be fair to the school, there was opportunity for other denominations to have their service. So, for instance, there was a mosque right opposite Kelly House where the Muslims could also go and pray on Fridays or any other time that they want and all that. So my question then is based on some of the differences, because we all come from different backgrounds, different persuasions, and there's the feeling that because a majority of us in Ghana are Christians, we do not necessarily understand, and we're in the majority, we do not appreciate minority views and the kind of, I wouldn't use the word oppression, but they are coward one way or the other, because there are people now coming on social media saying they went to Wesley Girls and they suffered some of these things in silence. So that's why I was asking the question that should we be looking at being more tolerant or accommodating of some of these people or people who belong to different religious denominations or different religions from the majority? Is this something that we should be critically looking at, or will it be too complicated in the sense that there are so many religions and we would have to make accommodations for everybody? What's your take on that, Honorable?
Okay, thank you. Let me say that I'm rather surprised at what is happening. We've been in this country. Mm. We've lived in peace. We've seen Shehu Sharabutu going to a Catholic church,
yeah.
You know, to celebrate 100 years. And you know, yeah. So what is this new thing? Is it it's because of... to ask the question, too much of freedom? I mean, it's rather strange to me, you know, that as if Wesley Girls had not existed, as if Wesley Girls have not had, you know, Muslims students before. Over the years. You know, like Papa said, maybe the way we are managing it. There's a freedom of religion and conscience. Yes, it is there. But does it mean we don't have to regulate it? I've said it somewhere.
Mm.
That, you know, if Paul Gagami is able to regulate what is happening in his country, why should we sit down and look on, say, oh, freedom of expression, freedom to do whatever you like, religion?
We always compare ourselves to them in a negative way.
You see, so what is happening? We are not students of Wesley Girls, so surely we will be reading from the media and other sources. I believe one of the issues, unless I got it wrong, is the time for serving of breakfast.
Yes, it's about the
feeding. You see, that because it should be done before sunrise, then somebody must be compelled to make sure that those who want to fast must eat before.
Yes.
That's before where five, the
problem
starts.
Mm. 5 to 6.
That's where the problem starts. I'm feeding you. You have your time to come to the, you know, assembly hall, dining hall. Now you are telling me I have to wake up early, change my time, and serve you earlier than that. That one I won't do. That is where I believe the problem started from. Because otherwise, I don't see it. If you want to fast, if you go to a dining hall, some of us who took the advantage of going through what we call pepper free.
the veggie people, you always had better. veggie.
We went ahead, we took our pepper free thing and all that, enjoyed it very well. You know, so seriously, you are now faced with a situation of like, you know, administratively, when you were going to school, you were given the rules. The children must sign, the parent must sign. Mm. You know what the rules are. Clearly, how do you now go there and determine what you want to do? Then you come back to the question of the constitution, which is the fundamental law. Mm.
Yeah.
If it allows for freedom of religion
and manifestation.
and even conscience.
Yeah.
I want to be a Rastafarian. That is what my conscience tells me. It is a little complex. It's a little complex, but I don't think that we should make it look as if it's a new phenomenon. We've lived with this thing for years, and we should just continue that way. Let them understand that you can fast if you want to fast. I mean, that is your headache. And like the school pointed out, if you have a problem, it should be that on your parents or your own self. You brought it onto yourself. It's not a problem for the school. You know, if we go about it that way, I think it should be okay, because in the first place, why were they admitted knowing that they are Muslims? They have already been admitted to the school. Nobody discriminated against them. Like the other way around, where Christians also choose to go to Muslim schools. You know, so
how many?
To me, what is happening now is too much of discussion.
Like I'm talking
too much of.
We are talking too much, which is taking the thing out of context and making it look at there's religious intolerance and all kinds of things. Bringing the Ghana Education Service, they give a directive. Then the Parent Teacher Association say, no way, we are supporting
the headmistress.
Whatever the headmistress has said is correct. Let's go on and all that. I think we should quieten down a bit. Allow things to work as it has been all the time. Like Madam said, if it is true that the parent went there, it was explained to the parent, even seemed to have understood the situation, then all of a sudden we get media.
Politicians get
yes, I know.
Issuing statements left and right.
But there are people saying, or some former students who are saying that they suffered some form of discrimination in our secondary schools, and we're not just limiting it to Wesley girls in general, like former students who are Muslim saying that they, and that's why I asked the question that maybe because a majority of us are Christians, we don't really understand or appreciate what minority religions go through. And so that's why I'm wondering, shouldn't, in this era of human rights, in this era, and you rightly point out the Constitution and all that, religious freedoms, shouldn't it be part and part, should it even be an issue in the first place that someone is a Muslim, we are in their holy month of Ramadan, he or she wants to fast? Why should it become a problem?
Because it's in an institution. You find yourself in an institution where there are rules, you know, and they are saying that for their rules, people of a certain age should not be permitted to do that. You chose to go to that school understanding all the issues that there are. You know, so for me, unless you want to test it in court,
I mean,
you are free. Take it up to go and test it that under the Constitution.
But I have
freedom of religion and conscience. And this is what I want to do. If somebody is telling me I cannot do that, I don't want to believe it, that person is right. He's infringing upon my rights. I want the court to come out and clarify
this. Just a quick one. I seem to be surrounded by lawyers. But all the thing, if we test things in court, court is very black and white adversarial and hostile. Is that the way we want to go?
Do we
want to make it hostile? I mean, I have been an advocate that the mission schools should collect their schools back. Because our schools, now you don't know whether the school is secular or it's a mission school. They say government-assisted mission school. So which is, you understand? There's too much confusion.
We're coming to that conversation.
The mission schools were mission schools that, look, the mission schools, the missions should be brave enough to say that we will pay our teachers. If you want to come here and get our education, you will pay the kind of fees that will give you that good education, because we are going to use it to pay our teachers. And break away and break away from this government assisted thing where we don't know whether they are secular or whatever, and the government comes. And in fact, it is the reason why our education has gone to the dogs. Yes, our education has gone to the dogs. And you know, because excellence counts for nothing. A child, it says that I want to go to Holy Child. They learn and they cram and everything, and they get the mark, 260, this thing. The government says this is the pass mark. they get 280 something, or no, these days is me, I'm talking about common standards. Let me talk about once and things. They get the requisite once, and then they go and put the child in some agroya sum school. This child is crying that I don't want to go there. I passed to go here. Then the government says that we are mixing it so that if there's equity and some other person who didn't get the requisite marks, you understand, go benefit because they went to some school somewhere and then bring them in. Look, what are we telling our children? That it doesn't pay to work hard. That excellence doesn't matter because you can work hard and get the grades and yet you will not get the school of your choice because of this thing. And a child who, by accident of birth, is Nagoyosum, gets a lower mark and is sitting in the place that you, after your hard work and working hard, goes there. Look, our children are demoralized right from there into believing that it doesn't matter what how much I learn, I will get the marks and I will not be able to get the school that I want to go. But somebody who didn't work or may have worked as hard, but unfortunately didn't make the marks and the circumstances of their birth, that person is not. Is it fair? Is that the kind of society?
Was it also fair in the past?
No, in the past it was fair. If you passed them, you think you got the school of your choice. You made choices. I mean, this is a situation where now
we are in the last one.
You
always prophesy. So
mediocrity in saying that you can only choose from this category of schools. You cannot choose. Look, I chose Holy Child, Wesley Girls, St. Rose's. Hey, wow. It didn't matter that they were all the same. I got the one that I wanted to go to. You were allowed to. Why would anybody restrict somebody to say that you can only choose from here and choose from here and then send? I mean, we need to strive from excellence. The balance is that you make the school in Agroyosum in such a way that they can compete with the school at East Legon. That is the social justice. That it doesn't matter the circumstances of your birth. You have the same opportunities to go anywhere. And that the government will make it possible for those who, by circumstances of birth, are in Agroyosum, and then be the same as a child who was born in East Legon. You understand that they have the same opportunities. The thing is not to disadvantage the child in East Legon in favor of the one in Agroyosum and make the one in East Legon feel as if it doesn't matter if I work hard. That is not the kind of education system we want to create. But anyway, coming back to
take
a bite of that particular one. Otherwise, this debate will continue next week.
Yes, because in terms of the mission schools getting their schools back. Look, we don't have the intolerance that, you know,
other countries have.
We are fairly tolerant of each other. You find that you know, people sometimes don't even, I mean, people don't even recognize that, oh, maybe if you are called Muhammad, this, you are Muslim. I mean, there are people that, I mean, when I was growing up, I didn't know if you were called Ibrahim or something, that you were Muslim. We didn't care. We played with them. These days, well, maybe with more knowledge at our fingertips, etc., we are noticing the differences. We want to keep the cohesion in this country. We must manage the things well, especially at our Ghana Education Service and all those things. They seem to jump into the fray too early, you understand, and come out with things that don't seem well thought through. And then they come and
muddy the waters. And then run away.
I think that we are not managing things well.
I think we should manage things more maturely,
think it through, and then come out with things that calm the waters instead of coming to stir them up. You get it? So the Ministry of Education, Ghana Health Service, whichever it is. I mean, I have my views about Ghana Health Service, especially when they were doing this free SHS thing, but that's a different discussion. They don't seem to be managing. They didn't manage the Rasta one well, and they don't seem to be managing this one as well. Which one next again? I mean, it's disappointing.
Let me Syria takes his last one. Let me just take my. I say this issue. I've been prophesying. I've been prophesying about it. You know, I when it started from this particular place where we discussed the Rastafarian.
Yeah.
I gave a historical analysis. I said this issue has been, you know, pending for a long time. It's been simmering, and that it's about time we had a national conversation about it and resolve it. I'm one of the biggest fans of this Minister of Education. I thought when he was a deputy minister, he spoke eloquently, he explains concepts very well. I think he is lacking the managerial skill and maturity to be able to deal with some of these thorny issues that must be dealt with in-house. As I said, as you were rightly saying, these are not matters you want to play out in court, for example. There should be no reason why the Catholic Bishops' Conference, the various heads of these religious institutions, mm-hmm. and the Ghana Education Service mm-hmm. cannot have a closed-door meeting and come out with clear guidelines. Because each of the religions has an education unit. I know there's a Catholic education unit. I know there's an Islamic education unit. They have been actually collaborating. Other than that, they couldn't run the educational system. Yeah. So this is an issue that should not even come out in the first place. Immediately, this matter began. The minister must necessarily stop whatever he's doing, call an emergency meeting behind closed doors, and resolve this particular issue. Because it is almost crazy that the educational authorities can come out with a directive and the schools can say we will not obey it.
Mm. Because they are not at Agroyesu.
it is a recipe for disaster. Because under the free SHS system, when you are headmaster and they were still insisting on collecting fees for PTA dues for the directives and the sanctions were swift. Immediately they find you out to be collecting illegal fees or whatever, the next day you are suspended. The next day you are transferred. They don't even give you the chance to be exchanging words with them, you know, because there was a clear directive that this is where we are going. This is how we are going to do it. This particular issue, when it comes to inter-religious, the interplay between religions in these schools, is one that can easily be managed because the regulations that would come out in respect of managing these things are not anything complex.
Mm.
If a student is a Muslim and wants to fast, it is merely administrative directive that make provision perhaps for breakfast to be given to them before 6 o'clock. Yeah.
And not to cut you, but just to join, I've received a message from someone saying that in Presec during Ramadan, Muslims get to have early breakfast
and their lunch. Yeah, I was in Presec.
Yeah, and their lunch and supper.
I was in Presec, but it didn't come on a silver plate.
Yeah.
I was part of the student movement at that time that fought to even give them a place of worship.
Mm.
They had not even got a place of worship for years. And Presec is well over 100 years, so you could imagine. It was in our time, Samuel Ablakwa and Red. That was the time that they started getting a place of worship. I give you the history behind that. So those things do not come on a silver platter. But my point is, if we have a conference of these institutions and they meet, you see, what the Methodist Church disliked, or what the other religious leaders and the other schools and this they dislike, is the directive and the flat out without regard to them, because they believe that the schools are ours. We manage them. There's a partnership. Then you get up and then you give us a directive. So I could understand their fear, because if you listen to the Methodist Church, the presiding the administrative bishop, his point was that, where would this end?
Yeah.
This comes in, we let it go. The next time we'll be told, give time for these people to read their books.
But is there anything wrong with that?
No. You see, the thing is this. These are educational institutions that you keep remember I said they are state run now, they are state funded, but they have a religious founding.
Yeah.
So as much as possible, if you are creating regulations, let those regulations be regulations that have come about as a result of consensus. And then let the regulations be clear uniform. Mm. There should not be one that is tilted in this particular person's favor or in this particular. But when there are regulations, let that be regulations that do not allow for human discretion in the sense as to make them discriminatory. Mm. It is important. If the time has come for a debate, not a debate, but a discussion on these issues, let that discussion be done in a matured way.
Yeah.
You see, taking into account the fact that we are not monolithic country. We are a secular country, different religions, we've lived together, and so these things must be handled very, very carefully. Other than that, you risk inter-religious clashes. Mm. Because it is very possible that at the end of the day, if you are not careful, these things now have taken a political turn. Mm. The parliamentarians have come in. And you could hear the Christian community also asking, why are the Christian MPs not talking? We do not want the politicians to get into this. So that is why I put this at the doorstep of the Minister of Education. He had the opportunity under the Rastafarian thing to resolve it. He gives a directive, and then the directive is ignored because he didn't consult. You don't give directives on such issues when you can talk to these people. These are not people that you cannot talk to. You actually meet them to discuss a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. So what is preventing you from sitting down with them behind closed doors, coming out with clear-cut guidelines? Because these are regulations that are not adverse to academic excellence. That is the purpose of the school. Mm-hmm. It's both the moral upbringing and the educational excellence that they want. So there must be a balance. And most of these things are not things that cannot be resolved. Like early breakfast,
making provision to serve them after.
Mm. These are things that can easily be regulated. The regulations come out as a result of a discussion. Mm. The communique is issued. All of them come together. Because remember, all the religions actually come together for various issues.
Yeah.
They came together when it came to the issue of homosexuality.
Yeah.
They actually met. It's not as if there's not an interbody. The National Peace Council is a body that has all religious institutions together. The Catholic Bishops Conference, the Methodist Church, the Islamic, they all meet when it comes to educational issues. I don't think that it may be a good solution not to have state intervention in these schools because of the issue of indoctrination. It is a dangerous thing if you allow the state to be absent from these educational institutions. Because that is where you breed the fundamentalist.
Religious
fundamentalism, yes. It's a national security issue.
The mission schools were put to evangelize.
It was for evangelization. That may be a purpose. But when you live in a secular state, you ought to be careful not to allow these schools to become the breeding ground. Other than that, one day you'll be there. There will be the same way we have Christian denominations. You could have a cult opening a school and telling you that it is on the basis of.
But we still can do that.
That is what I'm saying. I support the government intervention in these schools. There must be a relationship. Mm. There must be a balance.
Okay.
There must be an interaction. But these rules are rules that go to constitutional rights. So there must be a dialogue. There must be a collaboration. Mr. Minister of Education, you need to sit up.
Okay. Lawyer Alpon, so before you get, I know you have a lot to say, but just following up from what Nipapo just said, we know that I think it was in 2017 thereabouts where the president, Nanadu Dankwa-Akufo-Addo, I think it was an address to Trinity College or something, and he suggested that the government will be working to return the mission schools back to the churches. And I'm just bringing this because of what Nipapo talked about in terms of talking, and also I believe what Madam Eduamankwa is talking about in terms of the purpose for which these schools were set up.
Right.
And we know that these schools are public schools because the majority of the funding comes from the state. Yes, the church also contributes, old students contribute, but we still, and that's the confusion with whether they are assisted, what you were saying. So how does the state then ensure that people of all faiths, regardless of what your religious affiliation is, can still have a safe space in these public schools within which they can get their education?
Well, first, let us also acknowledge that a lot of these schools, the mission schools, either acquire their own properties with contribution from church members or other missions abroad. And so they own it. The government, as far as I can tell, has not compulsorily acquired these properties. So they are still the owners, the schools.
Okay.
In these schools, for example, if you, Pope John, for example, has a junior seminary where I attended 1-6. Still thinking of going back.
a priest.
A priest.
But so they, I understand the land was given to them by the Fidjasehene. Just because of some of the good deeds, because there's a huge hospital, St. Joseph Hospital, serving that community. They were famous for dealing with all bone-related matters. So they extended it, gave Pope John also that land. And I understand this with almost all the other missions. So they own the schools. In fact, the buildings were also put up with contribution, collections, and so on, grants given to them. So they also own it. So we have to look at not only the fact that their teachers are now being paid or otherwise being funded, but they own those institutions. The basic principle, which I know, in fact, informed the many boarding schools, whether for mission or not, is integration.
Okay.
Integration, whether on the basis of religion, ethnicity, and so on. And we all related very well.
Yeah.
We were separated from what we call the boarding house people. We were in a seminary.
Okay. For seminary.
Yes, secluded. On a separate,
you
the
only
same
went
land.
There because the
we were doing everything apart from out? Going for.
Why did you come out of the seminary?
Oh, many are called, but a few are chosen. There, you know that. You know that already. Except that we were attending classes with them, but we had our it's own dining hall. Subsequently, initially, we all attended the same dining hall, and so and we lived peacefully. I mean, the Muslims perform. Yeah. In fact, during Ramadan, we could even see them engaging in this activity.
Yeah.
So these things have happened. If you take the Methodist Church, if you want to identify one of these missions that don't play with their Lent and fasting during Lent, the Methodist mission or the denomination, it's one of the top. They don't joke with their fasting during Lent.
Yeah.
And so it is not just about isolating one group of religious sect or whatever. But it is something that we understand cut across.
Yeah, because now, even though Lent is taken seriously by the Methodist Church and fasting is, you're encouraged to fast and all that, in Wesley Girls, fasting is not allowed, even though it's a Methodist.
Yes. You see, we should also remember that most of these people are minors.
Yeah.
They're under the age of 18.
18, yeah.
The Children's Act, the Constitution insists that in all cases, their welfare is paramount.
Yeah.
So when you are considering this, and of course, Article 14.2 says your liberty may be varied a bit or may be taken away for the purpose of education or welfare of a person who has not attained the age of 18 years.
Yeah.
That is 14.1D. So, 14.1E. So we need to put all this together. And once they are under the care of these teachers and the schools, as we know, their welfare, which would have been the primary duty of their parents, has not been transferred to them as long as they are in school. And elsewhere, schools have had to suffer serious litigation issues because one way or the other, injury has been caused to a child and so on.
Yeah.
There have been cases of negligence.
Not even on the fault of the teachers, but actually on the fault of other students.
Yes, but they are still under your care. So we need to look at this, marry it with the need for integration, which no money can buy. That is what has brought all of us. That's why I'm one of the people who insist that we should rather be constructing more buildings in these already existing schools where the boarding, a lot of them are there anyway.
Yes, that's why we should add the
boarding facilities.
Yes, so we should add to the boarding facilities so that this very important core goal of integration is manifested. Otherwise, we will be going into this. So as Madam said, you see, then to come to a time that a lot of these mission schools will say, right, if you want to come to this school, you must be so-and-so. I mean, when I wanted to take my children to some Catholic, private Catholic school, the first thing they asked, are they baptized?
Yeah.
Because they are, and when I said no, they said, well, then, if you know you're a Catholic, they really admit them. I have to have them baptized anyway, but I refuse to give them any so-called Christian name. But the school they are in now, so they were in a private school. The girl had her hair on. Now she has cut it.
At that time, yes.
Yes. And in that other school, the boy was crying because they were laughing at him that his hair was also too low. Because it was a school that naturally the hair of the pupils should be high. Mm. And they didn't understand why my son's hair was usually low. So we had to leave it to grow up. Now here, his hair has to be low. You understand? But these are private schools, understandably. But a lot of it are based on the religious beliefs and belief systems of this institution. So for me, anything that will compromise the very important goal or policy of integration, we should deal with it in a way that will favor. Sometimes when I speak Hausa or even the main prayer in Christians, we call it maybe Our Father, mm-hmm. people are surprised. But it's because I associated myself with quite a number of Muslims, practicing Muslims.
Yeah.
And people are very happy when you are able to recite. Dr. Baumia gave a wonderful speech. I think if you find it and play it. In fact, he was able to establish that Mary's name is mentioned more times in the Quran than even in the Bible. The same thing as Jesus. He was just not even comparing, identifying many things that make us more in common. We have in common.
Yeah.
Yes. More in common. Yeah, it's Abraham. Yeah. Just that the one.
Two sons.
Yes. You see, so if you get, I think that particular speech should be found and repeatedly pronounced published. Because I was surprised to, even though I've been associated with Islam a bit, but I was surprised to find out how many we have in common. Mm-hmm. And even the Jesus that some Christians have appropriated as if he only came to save only Christians, have more mention of him and the wonderful things he did than in the Bible. And he kept on saying that. Perhaps the only difference is one thing that he's is God or Son of God, and the other thing is the greatest of all prophets. Maybe either before Muhammad and so on. So these things, we don't have. Look at Catholics. Look, the cassock that our fathers wear, Muslims wear it. And a lot of them, the genuflection, they also do it. Wash hands and feet sometimes before you say the mass. That's why when you go to Turkey, is it the Byzantine? Cathedral now then became a mosque. Now they've decided to leave it because they cannot say it's a mosque or it's a cathedral. But it is the Catholic Church, for example, is one that is quite pronounced in about 90% Islamic nation. You understand? So we have a lot in common, except that we haven't had the opportunity to know more about what is in the Quran than we know about the Bible. Because the Bible can be reproduced on your phone, on your iPad, wherever.
But the Quran
cannot do the same with the Quran. So I think that our brothers, the Muslim, Dr. Baumia has done, should also constantly preach to us, as to the extent that the Quran and the principles in it will permit them, publish these things so that we also understand that, look, there is nothing different from these two religions in particular. Accommodate one another
which
in these
doing for the time.
Yes. And so you can ask a legitimate question. Is this thing coming up now? Perhaps it's also about the positive activism that is going on social media. And then now
active spectators.
Yes. We are getting to know about this thing and be more assertive about this thing. But there is the need for the Islamic leaders, and including the one that Wahbi Wahab used to have,
the Ahmadiyya Muslim,
all those come together, Christian, Muslim. It's so easy now because Archbishop Bacchus has been
Palmer Bacchus.
Yes, going to the Honorable Shalibutu, the great
National
man.
Chief Imam.
National Chief Imam. They've been going to Dr. Baumia has been going to quite a number of churches. They pray there. We can also do that and live peacefully together.
Okay.
A quick one. I mean, I think that some of the things to, varying a little from the education is that we don't understand our religions well. We are not well schooled in our religions. Because you find out that those who understand our religions well, the Bishop Buckles and Chaributus, they can easily find common ground.
Yes.
It is the people who don't understand and they are the surface thing, and then they are the ones who are the ones, you know, then jumping on and fighting because they don't have the fundamentals. Because look, I am a Catholic. Catholics suffer more discrimination against, especially the other Christian groups than any other group. If I were to have said that, I would have listened to all the things that people say about the Catholic Church, I would not have been a Catholic. Mm. You understand? Because the kind of persecution.
Catholic priests,
they don't know the Bible. And there are some Catholics who don't even know that every day at Mass, by the time the year ends, would have read the whole Bible. And there are many Catholics who don't know that. There are many Catholics who don't understand the pouring of libation. If I can call on St. Catherine.
That's why they call it making of libation.
Yeah, and they think the making of libation, and then, what do you call it? They think it's fetish. I am Catholic. I call on St. Anthony. I call on St. Catherine.
I have a grotto in my house.
Why can I not call on my ancestor who I think that I said, Ekwu Abraham, she was a good woman, this, and call her to pray for me? So if somebody is pouring libation, as a Catholic,
you don't have any.
It doesn't move me one bit. It is not fetish because I do the same thing. You understand?
The universal church.
We have a lot of people who don't understand this, and then when these things happen and they are not handled well, then they come
the
and put fire.
Why I have a problem with the Minister of Education.
Okay, all right. You've made your point. Last question and 30 seconds each for you. But before then, Shabu Shabu is telling you, he says, Madam Amankwa, Agro Yesumfo will be very proud of you today. Are you from
that? Is there a town like that anyway?
Are you from that area? Okay, and Nikpapo, Prisek is not over 100 years. It was established in 1938, so it's 83 years.
The last one is Augustine's, right? Oh no, that there. Accra. Okay, right.
The last thing I'd like your take on is a Facebook viewer, Edubons Dominic, is saying this, and I would like your take in 30 seconds. He's saying the hypocrisy among Ghanaians is too much. When the Rastafarian kids and Achimota College brouhaha came, most of you guys and Ghanaians jumped to support the Achimota because Rastafarian sect has not got the numbers. But now most of you are supporting the Muslims and now talking about religious freedom. So the Rastafarian has no right. If we are talking about religious freedom, then it must be fair to all. Nigwabo. 30 seconds.
It's understandable. That's why I have always said we must have a national conversation about this. Mm. Again, I repeat, Mr. Minister of Education, sit up.
I have said that in all these negotiations, I mean, look at how the Chief Imam and the Muslims in Parliament have done it. I think if the Rastafarians had also tried to exhaust all avenues. I told one person that I don't think the president will sit by for somebody who is partaking in one of his most important policies. Not to go. So I even advise that they should write to the president. Mm. Let these boys themselves write a petition to the president and see if this, but not everything. We benefit from people engaging us to go to court.
Yeah.
But we must look at the overriding welfare of these children. It's not too late. I told one person last week, let these children appeal directly to the president. You think that if the president is not concerned, look at the steps the attorney general is taking in that case. It's going to end up in some settlement.
Yes.
But by the time it ends in that prolonged manner, the children may be told by the schools that you haven't spent sufficient time in school to even be allowed to write your exam. Negotiations first, alternative dispute resolution, especially mediation, like the religious. So not that anybody is against the Rastafarians. It is their right to go to court. But must we always start with a court?
It shouldn't be that.
Or even when you haven't exhausted negotiations, try and do so and appeal to the person whose decision is final on all these matters.
Okay, okay, so appeal. Honorable Iko, to 30 seconds.
Well, I've listened to all of them. It's not a bad idea, but I'm a courtroom practitioner. I believe in public interest litigation.
Yes.
And I would not, for my life, say that we should not explore that, because it settles issues, you know. We have the Children's Act, we have the constitutional provisions, we have Article 14, we have Article 24, 21. These are all issues bordering, you know, interpretation.
But before the negotiation.
Somebody can try it.
So we have finance.
You know, and tell us, because even Article 14, whether the liberty we are talking about is just the liberty to go about,
move about,
or liberty which would affect your conscience. So for public interest litigation, those who want to go to court, let them go. And let's get a clarity.
Well, that can be done.
Final word, Madam Adwamon.
The first part of the statement, I agree. We are hypocrites. That one I agree with. But the latter part, where I don't think they're discriminating against Rastafarians. I don't think the schools, you see, you are managing children, or and you have that difficult situation where they are in that adolescent age, where they have moved from JSS, where they think they are seniors, to come to a school where they are juniors.
Not juniors.
And then, you know, that kind of mixed thing, the hormones and things are raging. You have that difficulty. You want things to be as smooth as possible and regimental. You understand? So we have to understand that it has nothing to do with Rastafarians. Neither has it to do with Muslims. The schools want a certain level of discipline and as much peace as possible to manage the schools in an atmosphere where they can produce excellent
life.
So we need to understand that, and we need to begin to have those conversations. Because these things will continue to happen, you know, and people, the positive activism of the social media and people being able to express divergent views to the establishment, you know, will bring these things up. How we handle them is what is important.
What is important. Yeah. All right. Thank you all for contribution to this wonderful discussion. You've been listening to us here on the forum on Asasi Radio 99.5 megahertz. We've been talking about the Fix the Country movement, and we've also been talking about this issue of Wesley Girls, the religious dimension, and all that. And so, as tomorrow is Mother's Day, we wish all our mothers, wives, sisters a very good Mother's Day. We appreciate you. We care about you. We love you. And since Nick Papo is saying I'm a Mama B, I accept it on Mother's Day. I accept it, and I'm proud of it. Happy Mother's Day to us all. And as we always say, my mother, I'll talk to her. I'll talk to her in caucus. So until next week, stay informed and see you next week.